Good afternoon and welcome to the pre-drive drive. My name is Brent and we have Dangerous Dave! Dangerous Dave! The objectified dish. His hair is even longer. Ladies, he's been on the beach for the last 2 weeks in Cape Town. He's looking tanned. He's looking muscular. Arrrr, Dangerous Dave. Oh, stop it, Dave. We're just having a quick check around Ledwood Road in case young Hosanna has wandered away from his mother again. And if not, we're going to take a dash down to Cheetah Plains to look for Mr. Q, or Quarantine Male Leopard. It'll be quite nice to catch up with him. Haven't seen him in a while. It is scorchingly warm. It's about 98 Fahrenheit at the moment, 36 degrees Celsius. Dave, was the sun this hot on the Cape Town beaches?
Not quite.
No. Are you sure? Were you the hottest thing on the Cape Town beaches, Dave? Ah, Dave was the hottest thing on the Cape Town beaches. Now, if you could see, he's actually blushing now through his magnificent tan. Now, it is not cold, that is for sure. Dave, what else did you do on your leave apart from look hot on the beach?
He went for a few hikes.
You can't swim in Cape Town Sea, it'll freeze you. No, I put my toes in and I'm like, oh, it's okay, I'm done. I'm cool now. What hikes did you do? Skeleton Gorge. That's a good one. And you get to go to a beach on top of a mountain. There used to be a little man who used to sit in a hut on the other side of that damn wall. And we used to come swim there and he'd shout at us, but he was too lazy to walk all the way to the other side of the dam to stop us. Now, can you believe in Cape Town there is a beach on top of a mountain? So there's a dam on top of Table Mountain that is one of the water supplies for the city. And if you hike up Skeleton Gorge, at the end there's a perfect white beach at the dam. And it was a favorite spot when I was in that part of the world. We used to go up there about once a month. For our fitness in those days, we actually used to run up Table Mountain from the front side. You know where the cable car trail is? We used to run up and down. I was very fit back then, not so much these days. And you said you went ziplining. Did you go ziplining with your mom?
I should have.
As Dave told me, it's a very safe zip line. Not much adrenaline. You can take your mom on it, was his exact words. Dave, I hope your mom is watching right now. Hi, Ma. And what other hikes did you do, Dave? Which one? Lion's Head, Newlands. You didn't do Lion's Head. That's not a hike, that's a walk. Yes. Did you see Kirsten while you were in Cape Town? Kirsten didn't do any hikes, did she? No, Kirsten's lazy. And you know, with that pale skin of hers, she must stay out of the sunshine. So she probably didn't go to the beach either. Hey? Poor Kirsten. Oh, you did find her at the beach? She must have had special ginger sunblock on. Oh, well, it looks like we are coming quite close to going live with Master Henry, Commander Bond, Jimps, as he is widely known in the Lowveld. So we're going to make a dash towards Cheetah Plains while you go start the second part of the show with James.
This program features live coverage of an African safari. and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Africa. It's a glorious summer's afternoon, and this is Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
Good afternoon, especially to the children of Windsor Oaks Elementary School, Lynn Haven Elementary School, and Rosemont Forest. Lots of trees there in Virginia Beach, clearly. It's wonderful to have you chaps with us for the next 45 minutes. My name is James. On camera today is Brian. And Brian has got a mosquito on his thumb, and that is because it is summertime here, and there are many, many mosquitoes around the place. Now, over the course of the next 45 minutes, we'd love to hear from you, so ask us anything you like about what you're going to see. Hopefully, we'll find you some animals. It's very hot, so we're going to go and look in the shade and by the water. My friend Brent is out. He's heading far off to the east to see if we can find a leopard that we saw this morning, and Jamie, who's a lot more delicate than Brent, is out on foot around that way, and she's going to find you some tracks and birds and smaller stuff. But we're going to all try and find lovely, entertaining things for you from Africa. So any questions you have, send them through. Now, this is the world's most natural trampoline. I really quite like it, and I'm going to come back to the car now. Whoa, whoa, whoa. There we are. And then we'll go off to a waterhole, not too far from here, and see what else it is that we can find. It's 36 degrees Fahrenheit, if you can believe it. That's about 93 degrees Fahrenheit, which is very hot indeed. Okay, on we go. It's a lovely afternoon, and I know it's winter where you are, but it's summer here, and the sun doesn't let us forget that for one second. Let's see what else we can find around the corner here. There are lots and lots of birds around at the moment. Of course, summer is breeding time for the birds, and so they're all making nests. And you know what? I found three nests this morning, which for me is quite good. So I'll hopefully find a few more for you this afternoon. It's always so much fun to watch birds breeding and to watch little birds becoming big birds. Now, many of you have seen The Lion King, I'm sure, and you will know about Zazu. And Zazu is just over there. See? Now, Zazu's real name is the yellow-billed hornbill. Now, why do you think he's doing that with his beak? Why is it open? And you see his throat moving up and down? Tell your teacher why you think he's doing that. And I'm sure that you all know the answer, especially those of you who've got dogs and cats. You'll know, especially with dogs, that when it's so hot like this, they have to pant. And they pant because, unlike us, they don't sweat. So while we get sweaty under our arms and on top of our heads, birds don't sweat. And so they have to pant. And that has got a very fancy name, everyone. And that name is Gular Flutter. So say that with me, Gular Flutter. And this is a Gular pouch around the throat here. And they flap it up and down. Look. I'm asking Brian to do something very difficult. No, we're not going to get it. It's a dragonfly, everybody. And many of you have seen those around the place. Right. Jamie, like I said, is out on foot. She's going to find you some things that are closer to the ground. Let's go and find out what her plan is for the afternoon.
And a very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome to the on foot of portion of the Sunset Safari. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon Jandre is on camera with me, currently demonstrating his amazing ability to walk backwards without falling down. Be careful of termite mountains, Jandre, they like to pop out of nowhere. An especially warm welcome to all of the schools joining us. I hope you're really, really excited to be spending the afternoon just enjoying being with nature. And one of the best ways to do that is to be on foot and is to experience things at a much closer level, because the vehicles will get you nice and close to things like lions and elephants and leopards and all sorts of things like that. But being on foot gives you an opportunity to walk slowly through and see what you can find. And there's always all sorts of interesting things close to the ground. Now, even this, for example, it looks interesting to me, and that is a pile of antelope dung, all part of the ecosystem that we live in. Victoria, you want to know what kind of an ecosystem we're in. Well, we're in something known as a savanna ecosystem, it's almost a sort of a mixed woodland ecosystem, but it differs from place to place and from area to area. Now, we've started off our walk on the blistering hot open area that we're on at the moment. It's known as a clearing known as quarantine, and it's basically just grass and some very big trees. But very soon we're going to be going into what we would call a river system. So there's no river flowing, it hasn't flowed for a long, long time, we haven't had enough rain, but there are massive trees and all sorts of different plants and different animals that are associated with that. And that's only about 500 yards away from where we are. So our ecosystem sort of constantly changes, there's a whole load of different dynamics that we're going to try and show you. From the smallest insect to the biggest animal, to see if we can see one. I haven't seen an elephant in what feels like forever. I'm hoping perhaps we might have a chance to find one of them on our walk this afternoon. I mentioned that it's hot. It is very hot this afternoon. It's very warm. I'm not sure what the exact temperature, but it is quite sweaty. Abby, you wanted to know what animals we could expect to see. Abby, on foot, I could find you things like termites, although a lot of them are going to be hiding away because it is so hot. Spiders, scorpions, we've seen snakes on our bushwalks. We have seen some of the big animals too. Buffalo, those sorts of things. Buffalo, we've walked lions before. James had an incredible experience with a leopard on foot. And those are all the sorts of animals that you might see either on foot or on the drive. So we don't know what to expect because it is live and because this place is not a zoo. So all of these animals are completely 100% wild, and what that means is that we can't tell you what we don't know what we're going to see, so we can't necessarily tell you what we're going to see. You will definitely see an antelope. I've got a stone in my shoe. Just get that out. You're definitely going to see an antelope at some point. You could see something known as a warthog, like Pumbaa in The Lion King. You could see monkeys, you could see baboons, you could see, what else could we see? What would you like to see, Abby? That is the big question, of course. I'm hoping this afternoon to maybe find you a chameleon. I've decided that should be my project for this particular walk on foot. That's what I'm eager to see. There's another little animal that we could spot while we're on these walks, and it's not always about the big ones. There is a type of animal that live in these sorts of old termite mounds. Now, I don't see any sign of them at the moment, but there is a type of animal called a dwarf mongoose that loves to live in these little holes, and we'll be keeping an eye out for them as well because they're utterly adorable. They're like tiny, tiny little ferrets. Now, they don't need to worry too much about water, but remember how I said it is very hot this afternoon? Ian, you wanted to know how the animals get water. Well, out here on Juma, we've actually got several water holes. There's one maybe about 300 yards off to my left. There's a few puddles around still because we have had a little bit of rain. Not enough, but a little bit of rain to help keep the water well supplied. There's a water hole a mile that way, give or take, maybe just less than a mile that way. And what that is basically it is a man-made dam, but it fills up naturally with rainwater. And then in the height of our drought, what they will do is they will pump water to the water holes. So they will bring water up from underneath the surface of the soil, because there is water deep, deep down underneath, even where we're standing now, although you'd have to dig very far over here. to get there. But even where we're standing now, there is water underneath the ground. So that what they'll do is they will pump it up and they'll pump some of the water holes. Not all of them, because that takes a lot of water. But they'll pump enough for the animals to stay alive. And that's one of the things that they've been doing to try and help the various animals. Now, I just want to stop at this tree and see. No, this one's been lucky, it looks like. All of the silver clusterleaf trees, which is this tree, it's called a silver clusterleaf because, well, the leaves are silverish in the sun. And all of them are being fed on by a particular type of species of caterpillar that eventually turns into a really beautiful butterfly. And I wanted to show you them, but this one doesn't have any. This one's been a lucky tree. It doesn't have any sign of the caterpillars feeding upon it. Maybe we should try the next one and then the next one to see whether or not there are any of them there. And I'm thinking about perhaps even looking for some fruit that we can eat to help to keep ourselves cool on this particularly warm afternoon. Right, let us see. And it's also, of course, always important, because we are in the wilderness, it is important for us to remember that we are in the animal's home, and we've also got to be quite careful while we're on foot. We're always constantly be checking, constantly aware of our surroundings. It's fine in this big open clearing because we've got plenty of space. Now, it doesn't look as though there are any caterpillars in this area. So while I go off in search of very cool creepy crawlies to show you, let's head over to Brent and find out what his plans are.
Hello and welcome, kids. We are right down in the east of our Traverse area in an area called Cheetah Plains. Now, even though it's called Cheetah Plains, we're looking for leopard, but great to have all three schools with us on their own African adventure. So I'm hoping it's hot, it's 96 degrees Fahrenheit, that we might find some elephants. But before we do that, there's some baby impala and some mom impala as well. Hello, little guys. So, hello, Cammy. As Impala are moving off, Cammy is wondering, where do the animals get their food? Well, Cammy, if I was an impala and I was hungry, I would do... Wait, let's have a look a little bit further down the road for a tastier treat. If you're an impala, Cammy, not if you're a human being, but if you want a tastier, that looks like a tastier treat. This is where the animals get their food. From the bush around them. So this is not a zoo. No one feeds them. It's not very nice if you're a person though. No one feeds them, so they have to feed themselves. Let's not finish that. So if you're an impala, you eat leaves and grass. And if you're a lion or a leopard, you eat impala, but then you've got to catch them. So animals get their food from around them. So there's a big water hole near here that I want to have a quick look at in case there's some elephants maybe. Amara. Now, Amara is wondering, do we ever have winter or is it always hot? Well, Amara, we're in our summer at the moment, but we do have winter, but our winter, we don't have any snow. It just gets a little bit chilly. So not nearly as chilly as what you're used to, but we don't get any snow, but it can get quite cold. Okay, there's a water hole up ahead. Hello, Rolo. Rolo's wondering, how many times does it rain in a year? Well, we're actually in our rainy season now, and it seldom rains more than about 30 days a year in this area. We get about, on average, 350 millimeters of rain a year, which is a lot less than a lot of other places, but it is ideal for a lot of animals. Oh, there goes some more impala dashing across the road in front of us. Hello, little impala. That's a little boy. He was a baby last year. That's how big he grows in 1 year. Off he goes. Hello, Nima. Nima would like to know, what is an impala actually? Well, Nima, it is an antelope. So unlike the deer you get in America, an antelope keep its horns. They don't fall off every year. So if his horn breaks, it doesn't grow back. So an antelope is an antelope. So an impala is an antelope. Okay, it's very hot and dry. I wonder if there's any water left around here. If there's no water here, we're going to go look for some more water. I'm really hoping we can find some elephants, maybe a leopard if we're lucky. Let's have a look. Oh, there is some water here, but it doesn't look like the elephants have been here today. Hi, Emily. Emily says, well, if there's a drought, how does the water get into the water hole? Well, Emily, that's very clever. Well, we have had a bit of rain, so even though the drought has sort of come to an end, so we do have rain, and then some of the water holes, people put water into them. But most of the water holes are filled by rain. We have had a little bit of rain so far this year. No elephants. We're going to have to go look further to the east. So while we look for the big, big animals, it seems like Jamie's found a tiny one.
A tiny, but if you are another bug or another beetle, actually quite a scary insect. And this particular little guy with its bright red and black colouring is something known as an assassin bug. I was going to try and show you something else, but it just ran away. So we'll stick with our assassin bug for now. Now, assassin bugs are exceptional hunters of other insects. So they'll go after different things, and there are different types of assassin bugs. Some of them go after ants, some of them go after termites, some of them will go after other bugs or spiders on the flower. I'm trying to move it slightly so that we can see it, but it doesn't want to be seen. Brightly colored. Now, how many of you know about when nature has bright colors? It's usually trying to warn you that that particular insect or that particular animal is dangerous in some way. So a brightly colored caterpillar, or perhaps a brightly colored snake or butterfly, they're trying to tell you that they're dangerous, that they're toxic in some way, or that they produce something scary, or that they can bite very hard. It's called aposematic coloring, and it's essentially nature's way of avoiding a fight if absolutely possible. So if you've got something red and black and yellow, startling colors, then that insect is probably poisonous to eat. Monarch butterflies are a really good idea, or a really good example. There are some insects, though, that are completely harmless, but they have learnt, or through evolution, have come to have the same bright colors, even though they're not poisonous at all, even though they are not toxic in any way. They've imitated the colors of toxic animals so that the predators stay away from them, so that the predators don't go after them. So nature is amazing in the way that she designs the different insects. If it's a mammal species, while most mammals don't see in the same color that we do as human beings, some of the primates do, and the predators can see in limited color. But in that case, then, the animals that want to try and have aposematic coloring will have black and white, like honey badgers. Now, Jack, you say, can assassin bugs break human skin? And that's a very good question, Jack, because not all of them can, and not all insects can. You might have heard of a spider called the daddy long legs. That's a very good example of a spider that cannot break human skin. And the answer with this one is probably yes, but only if he was at a sort of a sensitive part of the skin. I don't think if I were to, in fact, I think if I'm going to touch him now, he's going to fly away, which I don't want to do. I just want to show you how big he is compared to my fingernail. And I don't think it can, just judging by the size of its mouth parts. I think it probably could on sensitive skin, but on the tough and hard skin of my fingers, because of course your skin is much tougher on your hands and on your fingertips, on the tough, hard skin of my finger, I don't think he'd actually manage. I don't think he'd have much success. And he's living on a type of flower, it's one of my favourite flowers that we get out here, called a string of stars. But unfortunately, it's past its flowering point, so most of the flowers have died off. But a string of stars is a really, really nice, particularly beautiful plant. Samantha, what a lovely question coming through from you. And let's hop up and carry on our journey, because it's getting quite hot in the sun and there's no shade where we are, so we'll keep walking so that we can chat about the answer to it. Samantha wants to know if there's any plants that will store water for the different animals. Yes, Samantha, there are plants. I just wanted to check around here. No, I think it's run away. There was a spider that I wanted to show you, but unfortunately you've got to pick and choose which animals are going to be available when you first start. So Samantha, there's something known as an African potato. That is a type of plant that the animals know that if they could dig up, they will be able to get to the bulb underneath. And the bulb is much like a normal potato. It's full of water, it's full of starch, and it's a very good source of food and water for the different animals, and potentially for human beings as well. So there are different types of plant. Now, we don't get the big melons that you might find in the desert that a lot of the animals rely upon, but lots and lots of these plants, even if I were to, and let's find a good example here. I want to show you a good example of where an elephant has pushed over a tree and brought up the roots, because of course every plant has a root system, or at least every tree and big plant has a root system that acts as a place to store water. And if you're a big elephant, that is a wonderful place to go and to chew, especially in our winter time, because our winter we actually more typically call our dry season, because that is when it's the driest. We don't have any rain at that time of year. Now in summer here in South Africa, that's when we get our rain, at least in this part of South Africa. So in winter, what elephants will do, and this isn't the best example, this tree's actually survived, but at some point a massive elephant, this whole tree here at some point was standing upright. It would have been an upright tree, this part here. And at some point, an elephant has come up to the tree, put its head up against it, or its trunk, and pushed against it, and pushed and pushed and rocked until this tree fell down and landed on its side. And then what the elephant would have done is probably wouldn't have snacked on the leaves, because actually these leaves are really gross. And I know if I offered Jandre a bite of one, he would say, no, thank you very much. You want some? All right, we'll both do it. How's about that? Jandre is saying, yes, he will. He will try a leaf. I'll try and find a nice... Let's split one, because I don't feel like eating a whole leaf. And I'll show you why the elephants probably wouldn't have been after the leaves. Because when you put it in your mouth, which I'm going to do now, it takes... I'm not going to follow that. It takes away all of your spit or your saliva. It's very astringent. So elephants only eat this when they're absolutely desperate. Jandre? There we go, into Jandre's mouth. We're going to have to go and find some water after this. But what the elephant would have been after would have been the root systems. Now, what's happened here, and why this isn't the best example, but I was trying to find you a good example and I couldn't find one right away, is that this tree's actually survived. So an elephant has come and fed off the roots here. Long, long time ago, this would have been where the elephants were chewing on the roots that have been dug up, and they are sticking out. And they would have got lots and lots of water from that. But somehow, because this tree still had some roots, there you go, this is roots here, this is a big root over here. Because it still has roots attached to the soil and still in the soil itself, it survived. And there it is, up like growing upwards now. So this whole tree is still alive despite the fact that it's been pushed onto its side. Now, Elijah, you want to know how an elephant push a tree over. I'm going to show you. Except I'm going to take a much smaller tree. Now, I am not a very big person, as you may or may not have noticed. I'm not a particularly big human. An elephant is probably a little bit bigger than me. Not probably, definitely. But let's pretend that I am a 5-ton elephant. I need to find an appropriately sized tree for this. This could be interesting. That one's got thorns. I don't want to push that one over. I feel like I might have tied myself into a knot here. Let me find one. Okay, we'll go with the monkey orange. No, we'll go with the acacia tree. That's cheating, isn't it? Well, I suppose maybe not. If I were 5 tons, which I'm not, which is over 10,000 pounds, which I'm not, this tree would be proportionately much, much larger than it is. So what an elephant does is, because they are so incredibly strong, this is a silly idea, this has got thorns, they put their head up against the tree and they slowly but surely push. And I'm not going to do this because I don't want to poke my eye out. But they'll push and they'll push and they'll push until eventually the weight of the tree pushes it over. Now, I'm not going to push this poor tree over. It didn't do anything to me. It didn't offend me in any way. So I'm going to leave it alone. Although, an elephant has been feeding here. You can see it's been chewed by an elephant at some point. Right, well, since I failed in my task of pushing over a tree, you'll just have to take my word to it that elephants are very big and very good at pushing over trees. Let us, I think, change the subject and head over to James so that we can find out what he's doing.
Yuck! Now, as Jamie was showing you, those leaves don't taste so good, and the reason I'm eating them is because we're stuck. We have nowhere to go. I've had to climb this tree in order to try and find something for Brian and I to eat. We've got a flat tire, and we don't have a spare tire. So we're going to be stuck here probably for the next 2 months. What are we going to eat, Brian?
I don't know.
I don't know either, but it's not going to be leaves. And what you have to understand out here, everybody, is that if you cannot hunt things, well, then it's quite difficult. Now, I'm not a very good hunter, so I don't know what we're going to eat out here while we wait for someone to come and help us. Probably some caterpillars. We could eat those. Probably some fruits. We'll try and find some fruits. But what I am going to show you while I sit in here and think about what on earth it is that I'm going to have for dinner, I'm going to show you this funny leaf. Can you see that it's got a little piece of missing green in the middle of it? Can you see that, Brian? What that is called, everybody, is a leaf tear. Now, a leaf tear is a very special kind of caterpillar, and it's such a special caterpillar, and it's so small that it's able to eat in the middle of the leaf. Now, you all know what a leaf looks like. You've all held leaves in your hands. You know that they are very, very thin. So if I bring the leaf back here, you can see it's very thin. Ooh, I nearly fell out the tree there. It's very thin indeed. But there's a caterpillar living between the top and the bottom, and that's called a leaf tear. And he manages to eat the middle, and that means that he doesn't have to eat the really hard, horrible stuff in the middle. Anyway, this particular tree is not going to be good for us to eat. And the only other thing I wanted to show you was basically how a baboon or a monkey would do. And they'd sit in a tree like this, and they would find fruits and eat them. And maybe they'd find a caterpillar. They'd look on the branch like this and eat a caterpillar. And then they'd scratch a little bit like this. And then they'd probably help their friends have a little bit of a scratch. And that's what they'll do. And hopefully we'll see one of them. Now, I suppose, Brian, I should try and get out of this tree, shouldn't I? Do you think I'm going to hurt myself, Brian? I hope so, too. Oh, dear, everybody. I didn't expect the tree to break. Anyway, there it is. You can see we were talking about elephants. Jamie tried to push the tree over. She didn't manage to do it. We managed to break our tree, didn't we, Brian?
Indeed.
I think that's quite impressive, really. Anyway, marvellous. Good. Okay, excellent. Let me go around this way. We really can't go anywhere there, everybody. We're just going to have to plug in a little bit, see if you've got any questions for us, and then we'll probably head across to... Oh, we do have a question. Hello, Niall. You're wondering if we eat any of the animals. Niall, we would if we could eat some of the animals, but it's very difficult to catch them. Now, in ancient times, or in fact not very ancient times, a few hundred years ago, people would absolutely catch things like impala. I don't know if you've seen any impala today, because I've been stuck in a tree. But impala are a small antelope about the size of a white-tailed deer, and one of those would feed a family for about a week. So absolutely, people used to eat the animals here. I have eaten some impala sometimes, very delicious indeed. Sometimes warthog, which is like a pig, and we eat those sometimes. But you don't have to eat a lot of animal out here to get enough meat and enough food. So really, you know, if you did eat animals out here, it would be absolutely fine. We wouldn't do any damage to the ecosystem because, you know, we of course are predators, aren't we, Brian?
We are.
We are indeed predators. Okay, let's see if I can't find something else over here. Hang on, there is a question. Ooh, Ella, you're wondering about how many leaves are poisonous. Ella, there are not many poisonous leaves around here. There are one or two. One specifically, which I can't see around here, is called a tumbuerti. And tumbuerti, it produces a sap. And now this is a very important lesson for anybody who goes into the wilderness to learn. If a tree produces a white sap, we call it latex. If a tree produces that, it's almost certainly going to be probably slightly poisonous, so then you don't eat it and you don't touch it. You don't put anything in your mouth in the wild unless you know exactly what that tree is and if it is causing or can possibly cause some harm. I wouldn't put anything in my mouth that I couldn't identify. And that's especially true in a wilderness area that perhaps you don't understand. Okay, that's very important, everybody. Right, let's go and have a little look around here and see if we can't find something else. Because, you know, around in the bush, what you find is that every little piece of wilderness is an ecosystem on its own. So if I look at this broken down tree, it might look like a piece of kind of bush rubbish, if you like, but I bet you that if I lift it up, we will find something interesting underneath it. I hope that we will find something interesting under, well, here we go. Look at this. This is actually quite interesting. Let's have a look here. Even this tiny, funny piece of branch, old piece of wood, is a kind of ecosystem on its own. Now, we're going to be quite careful about opening it up because you can see there that very clearly there have been spiders living here, and many of you will be quite afraid of spiders, I imagine. Now, spiders that like to live under this sort of thing, see the spider. I just want to hold the leaf there because I don't want the spider to come towards me. Now this, everybody, I think is actually a very small, what we call violin spider. Now this is exactly the spider that I was hoping to find for you because it's actually quite dangerous. Now, very few spiders out here are dangerous at all. Most of them are completely harmless. But this violin spider is quite dangerous to people. If it bit me, I would probably be very sore, and it would also make it difficult for me to breathe. It would start, the poison would act on my lungs and what we call my nervous system, and so I would struggle to be able to breathe, and I might even vomit and become sick. I don't think it would kill me, but it would certainly make me very sick indeed, and this is what I was hoping to find under here. But now, I've said the spider is dangerous. It's only dangerous if you are nasty to the spider. So I've been a little bit nasty to the spider by sort of disturbing it. So while you look at it, let me just find out if there are any questions that you might have. I'll plug myself back in so that I can hear Kirsten, who's directing and taking your questions. There we go. I've been a little bit nasty to this thing by disturbing it, I'm afraid. But we're going to put it back. And remember that when you're out in the wilderness, you must make very sure that you put back whatever it is that you've moved and that you don't leave anything that you didn't take there yourself. Okay, so that's an important lesson. All right, let's put him back there. I don't want to disturb him for too long. It's actually probably a she, and I don't want to disturb her for too long. When she's big, everyone, she will be that big. She'll be that big. Isn't that interesting? Nima, you wonder why she lives in the bark like this. Well, she lives in the bark, Nima, because this is where what she likes to eat lives, and it's a really good place for her to escape from things that like to eat her. So a bird would eat her, or maybe a mongoose. A mongoose is a little mammal that would come along and turn over all the logs just like I did and find a spider like that and swallow it. You can eat things like this if you have to. They're not too dangerous to eat. It's if they bite you that it's a problem. And Nina, if we look... Ooh, this is amazing. Hang on, there's another spider in here. There. Brian, can you see it just glistening in the sunlight there? It's right underneath. Anyway, I think this one might be the mother, or maybe that's the female and this is the male. Remember, female spiders always much bigger than male spiders. Now, we have a very, very, very special treat for you, everybody. While we try and figure our way out of living in the wilderness for the rest of our lives, Brent Leo Smith is off to the Far East, and he has got Amazing Prince of Cats. Go and take a look.
Indeed we do. Jamie found him this morning and we've been checking every patch of shade near where he was left, and we have found him. He is a magnificent male leopard. Isn't he beautiful? He's also very hot like us, but unlike us he can't sweat. So if he moves around too much in the heat, it can be quite bad for him. Now, Jameer is wondering, are leopards carnivores? Indeed they are, Jameer. So those little impala we saw earlier would be perfect for him to catch and eat. So he eats meat, so he's got to catch it. And because out here, there's no grocery store for the animals. They've got to go get their own dinner. Now, of course, the impalas are very fast, so they can be quite difficult to catch. And for every animal he chases, he only catches probably about 1 in 10. Now he's just over 4 years old and he's turning into a really beautiful, beautiful male leopard. Now I've been watching him for nearly 2 years now. He is magnificent. Hey, big boy. Hi, Cameron. Cameron wants to know, do leopards climb trees? They can, Cameron. They're actually, out of all the big cats, they're the best tree climbers. They are able to take almost their whole body weight up a tree. So he probably weighs about 180 pounds, and he could probably take another 180 pound animal that he's caught up the tree with him. Fiona's wondering, what else do leopards eat besides impala? Well, Fiona, he eats all small to medium-sized antelope. So, and he, being a male leopard, can actually eat some big antelope. Kudu, inyala, bushbuck, duiker, steenbok. He'll even go at baby zebra, baby wildebeest. So he's got quite a varied diet, but leopards are really adaptable. They'll also eat birds and snakes and fish. Oh, is he moving deeper into the shade? So when he moves like that, it means he's been lying in one spot for so long that the ground underneath him has got hot. So he's just trying to move to a slightly cooler piece of ground. Now, leopards normally hunt at night, but all predators are opportunists. So if something happened to wander up towards him, and Jerry was wondering about that. But if something happened to wander up here now, he would definitely, oh, look at those teeth, take advantage of it. Normally they hunt at night, but they will try at any time of the day if there's a chance. Now, Mrs. Ballard would like me to tell you guys what the difference is between a leopard and a cheetah. Now, apart from their build, leopards are actually quite a lot bigger more muscular than cheetah. Cheetah are taller and skinnier and don't weigh as much and are not as strong. And also, if you look at the leopard's eyes, you'll see there's white or a pale color under the leopard's eyes, and that is to make sure that he can grab all the ambient light from around when he's hunting at night, whereas cheetah is more of a diurnal hunter, so they will hunt during the day. And also, if we look at his body, you can see there's lots of spots, but they're more rosettes, but a cheetah is completely spotted. So there we go, that is what a cheetah looks like. You see it's got black under the eyes. We can zoom a bit more there. So there we go, you can see the black under the eyes, and you can see a different shaped head, a much more round head, and more rounded ears, and you can see the body is far more streamlined, far more subtly built, so built for speed and not so much for strength. And as I said, the spot, when we look at him, he's got what we call rosettes. So he's got spots, and then he's got a darker color in the middle. So very, very different. And also very different, leopards are mostly nocturnal. Cheetah are diurnal, or mostly actually crepuscular. Now, crepuscular is a wonderful word. It means most active at dusk and dawn. Now, what Mr. Quarantine, this leopard, is going to do is going to wait till it gets cooler before he moves anywhere. He's going to sit here in the shade enjoying a bit of a breeze, and hopefully for him, the biting flies don't find him, because that's the only thing that might make him move in this heat. But while we sit here to see what he does next, let's go back to Jamie, who's out on foot.
Something fascinating to show. Perhaps not quite as fascinating as a quarantine beautiful male leopard, and I'm so glad that you've had a chance to see him. I had a centipede to show you, but it's gone, and I have absolutely no idea where on earth it has vanished to. It has all but completely disappeared. It must have gone into this leaf litter somewhere. I'm hesitant. Now, centipedes are... thought I saw it, but I did not. Centipedes are one of my least favorite animals, but they are fascinating. They've got a very, very strong bite, and it's actually quite a venomous bite, so it is a sore bite. It won't kill you. It's not like a very dangerous snake, but it does make you feel very, very uncomfortable. Now, the last time I saw this centipede, it was running towards Gendre, so I'm not entirely sure if it's not somewhere in Gendre's shoe, maybe in his socks, just sort of aiming to try and bite him on the ankle. Who knows? But it's vanished. It has completely disappeared. We're going to stay away from these thick areas. So what we're doing at the moment is we're walking through, and I don't see it anywhere, Gendre. I'll let you know when we are on foot. And there's some really, really dense trees here. So we're walking. We don't bump into any animals that are hiding there in shade. I wanted to know, are there more herbivores, carnivores, or omnivores? There are more herbivores by a very, very big stretch. So there's one type of antelope called an impala, that there are nearly 100,000 in this particular area, and that's just one species of antelope. And we've got somewhere around 13 to 15 different species of antelope. One species, 100,000 antelope. There are probably roughly around 15 or so thousand elephants. But to compare those to carnivores, for example, there are around 2,000 lions, around 2,000 leopards, maybe 1,000 cheetah, give or take, and around about 500 wild dog. So there are far less carnivores than there are herbivores. That's the big carnivores, though. There's also, bear in mind, there's also little carnivores, something like a dwarf mongoose, for example. And there's probably slightly more dwarf mongoose in this area than there are anywhere, than there are lions or leopards or something like that. But generally, almost always, in almost any ecosystem, you'll find that there are more herbivores than there are carnivores. And that's because of the energy loss in the feeding, sort of the feeding process. So herbivores eat from plants, that's their primary source of nutrients. And a bit of that energy is lost, but a lot of it goes into the herbivore. Then when the predator comes along, the carnivore comes along and eats that animal, a lot of the energy is lost there. So there need to be more herbivores to support the carnivores and keep the nature, or keep nature in a balance. So to make sure that there's... No, go away, Fi. It's about to land on my nose. To make sure that there are enough to feed the herbivores, but also not too many carnivores, that they eat all the herbivores and then the herbivores can't survive. So it's a very, very delicate balance. Omnivores, there's probably about the same amount, maybe just a little bit more than the predators, but I think there's probably about equal the amount of omnivores and predators. I think let us walk back around here because it is getting quite sweaty. So I'm going to go off and find some shade. Now, I hear very sadly that it is time to say goodbye to the three schools that joined us for this afternoon. I'm sorry to hear that, and I hope that you had an amazing time and that the rest of your school day is as exciting as this particular part was. And I hope that we will see you again very shortly, and there will be some names that I recognize answering questions. Bye-bye to all of you, and for our regular viewers, we will catch up with you soon.
So we're still sitting next to one of our favorite leopards, Mr. Q. Now he hasn't moved too far from where Jamie left him this morning, maybe about 50 or 60 meters. Probably fine trying to escape the biting flies. But resting up in the shade of a quarry bush. Now Jamie said he looked like he was on a mission this morning, so hopefully he continues to mission as it gets a bit cooler. I don't think he's going to move too far for the next little while. Hi Joshua. Joshua's wondering how we tell the gender and age of leopards. Well, from his physical size, you can immediately see he's a male. We know his specific age because we know when he was born. He is one of Karula's successful litters, and he had a brother, a litter mate called Konyuma. But Konyuma has moved south of the northern Sabi Sands into the central Sabi Sands, where his quarantine has moved out to the east, but has stayed in the north. Now, I would have probably, if I hadn't known how old he is, I probably would have said he was a bit older. He's very big for his age. The fact that he's scent marking and putting pressure on his older half-brother, Shivambalan, already is incredible. And he is a beast for his age. But generally, you look at the size, you look at his face, you look at how many scars, tatters, you look at the ears, and on sort of male leopards over 6 or 7 years old, you've got a very defined dewlap. His dewlap isn't quite there yet, but it's getting there. Hey, mister. He is an incredible, incredible leopard. Very, very relaxed, and often in the past, he's given us hours and hours of sensational viewing, even when he is trying to bite the biting flies back. For me, he's just always been a very active leopard in comparison to the others. I mean, even though it's hot, his head's up. Hello, Rebecca. Rebecca's wondering, do leopards come in black? Indeed they do, Rebecca. It's a very, very rare form of pigment or colour variation. It's a recessive gene, and it's called menilism. So black panthers are actually black leopards, and they come from certain parts of India. They've been recorded certain parts of Africa, not too far from here, up in the mountains and in the rainforests of central Congo. I've actually seen a black leopard in the wild, in northern Zululand of all places, but I was quite young. But very, very, very rare. Now, even though they are black, you can still see the rosettes through the skin. Well, we're going to sit here and wait for Mr. Q to get on the move while we do that. It seems like Commander Bond has repaired all his tires.
Now, everybody, Brent Leo Smith came across here the other day and he found himself a painted snipe. Now, a painted snipe is a very rare bird, and his affianced came here the day after that, and I'm afraid she couldn't find it, so he was not flavour of the month. Let's see if we can spot it here. There are two Egyptian gooses, the worst parents of Juma. There they are. That's one of them. They've obviously had a lover's spat. That's probably why it is they're not very good at raising their babies. And we did see two other Egyptian gooses at Twin Dams about 2 days ago, and they seem to be much more successful. They've got eight little goslings. I do not see a painted snipe anywhere. Do you, Brian?
No.
Are you aware of what a painted snipe looks like?
No.
I will therefore show you in the book so that when you look around and see a bird that looks like a painted snipe, you might say to me, "Oh, James, I seem to have spotted a painted snipe." And I may then train my binoculars on it, and we shall whoop and yell for joy at the sight of the painted snipe. Are you with me?
Yes.
Excellent. There is the painted snipe, number two. A very small bird, just 1 foot long. That looks quite big for a painted snipe. Anyway, that's how big he, that's what he looks like. And you can see why he's called a painted snipe. Can you see, Brian?
Okay.
It's because he looks quite painted.
Mm.
And he's got pretty yellow legs. Very nice. And he likes to live here in amongst the mud and eating probably little snails and things, I suspect. But we don't find them here often. They're often in much more marshy, wet areas than this. And so I think he was probably here by mistake on his way to somewhere else. There is, however, also a three-banded plover. And that looks like quite a young one. They are not migratory. Well, they're one of the few non-migratory plovers. I'm just going to have one more look. Now, I must just tell you, it's quite amusing. On the radio, there is a new fellow in one of the camps, and so listening to him trying to navigate the radio as if it's some kind of telephone is very amusing indeed. Anyway, there we have it. Now, I'm just going to quickly talk to Johan on the Game Drive channel because he's looking for me. I'm quite honoured to be looked for at all. And there's Bivouac Dam. There was a time, of course, when we had so many buffalo here and various elephant herds coming down to drink. Anyway, while I get hold of Johan, Jamie has a track. Hopefully it leads to an animal. We'll catch up with you shortly.
I'm on the track.
Well, we have a track that... Well, I don't think it's going to lead to an animal unless we want to really work very hard at trying to track down a squirrel, which will be relatively tricky to do. But what we do have is a mystery that Herbie has found for us. Now, Herbie, by the way, you might see him every now and again. He is the character, the guide who walks ahead of us and makes sure that we're safe. And he's found this for us. And it's a very, very interesting track indeed. This, first of all, what I wanted to show you... is what a difference light makes in terms of seeing a track like this. And Jandre, if I do this, does it make it clearer?
Yeah.
It does, much clearer. It does to me. To me, on where I am, it makes it hugely clear, or a huge difference to the way in which I can see the track. So this is a squirrel track, apparently. I didn't call it as a squirrel track at first. I was going with something else. I thought it was a little bit large for a squirrel track. But then, of course, Herbie reminded me very succinctly that tracks spread out as mud gets drier. So this is the back of the foot, and these are the delicate little toes. My first thought was Janet, but it's too small. And it's also got five toes, not four, of a Janet. But the most interesting aspect of it, if I take the shade away just so I can show you what remains, the most interesting aspect of it is what this on earth the squirrel was doing. So we're in a dried up puddle, and actually quite a pungent dried up puddle now that I'm spending a bit more time down here. It's actually quite stinky. And this squirrel must have come and stood essentially on its back leg, so it would that one track has got to be its back leg track. The other one is in the crack of the mud and you can't really see it in any detail, and then dug. So it was digging for something, and that's the only explanation behind these incredible I nearly slid into the puddle itself, into these scratch marks. And this here would have presumably been where whatever it was after. As to what it was after, your guess is absolutely as good as mine. I don't want to stand in here. But it is interesting. Herbie suggested, and Jandre both suggested, a bug, that perhaps it was after some kind of bug. I'm bemused by that. It seems like an awful lot of effort, because if I do something quite revolting, if I start digging in here, this is seriously, seriously clayey. Now, I really would like to antiseptic my hands after this, or at least give them a good wash when I get home. This is seriously clayey. Now, imagine a squirrel. Ugh. Seriously, this is clay. Look here. It's still on my fingers. It won't get off. So imagine a squirrel, tiny little feet, delicate little paws, with all of that fine fur all the way around it. And squirrels do have delicate fur all in between their pads, and they have sharp little nails. Now imagine it scurrying through this thick mud. What an incredible mission that must have been for the squirrel afterwards to then sit and clean it off, essentially, to get rid of this mud. And it would have had to, because this is actually, I mean, goodness gracious, this is sticky. I can't get it off at all. This would have been a serious mission to try and rub off its fur. So what on earth this nut job squirrel was doing is the essence of my segment here. What on earth this crazy, stupid little squirrel was doing, I do not know. All I know is that it's left an amazing amount of claw marks that have gone very deep and actually give us an idea of just how sharp a little squirrel's claws are. The other interesting thing, of course, is that it's done it here. Can you see it there, Jandre? And here. What were you after, little squirrel, in the cracks of this mud? Ooh, smelly. What was in here? I've been trying to figure this out and wondered if maybe it wasn't a frog living in the mud. But I doubt it. Don't think so. I mean, not really in the typical diet of a squirrel. I suppose it's possible. Anything's possible. I have to confess, when I first saw it, I thought it was Herbie scratching with a stick. That's what I thought that he'd been up to. And something else has been through here as well, now that I look at this. Now, Christopher, you want to know, because there in the US, where you are, you have something called a mud wasp, and you were wondering if we have them here as well. We do. We do have wasps that do use mud. There are some called potter wasps that will build it around. Jerry's got one living in her bedroom. Jandre, didn't you have one living in your room? Kirsty. Kirsty's got one living in her room. That's who it is. Kirsty's got one living in her room. So, yes, we do have, I don't know if they're part of the same family, or if they have if it's an example of convergent evolution, in that you've got two different species that have evolved separately to do something very similar, there's a very, very good chance that they relate to the same family. So yes, we do have them here. And speaking of things that are related, or at least connected to each other in some way, Brent's had a leopard. Let's go and have a look at a leopard tortoise with James.
Right, everybody, I'm out of the car because this tortoise was moving away and I didn't want him to disappear before you came to us. He was having a drink here and I'm just a little worried that we've disturbed him. So before we continue looking at him, I'm going to grab the vehicle and go around the other side of him because the sun, as you can see, is completely on the wrong side of him there. So let's just move around. He is a leopard tortoise, obviously, but he's a very big one. He's about a foot large. Let me just quickly move around this little puddle. There we go. There he's now highly mobile, Brian. You see that? Can you keep up with him, or will it be blurry? Look at him go, everybody. He's in a real rush now to get to the greenery. He's had his drink, now he wants something to eat. And who knows if he'll get there in the next week or the next month. Stealthy as he goes, wizened old face stuck out of his very pretty mottled shell, blinking away the sunlight. Very pleased for the greenery of the summer. I suspect what he's going to do in all seriousness is head towards that next thicket there, see if he can get himself into some shade where he thinks we can't see him anymore. So if you've got all afternoon, we'll just probably sit here and watch him, won't we, Brian?
We will.
Yes. There he goes. Come on. That's it. Well done. I mean, there must be literally thousands of these things around here, all of them now sitting in shade like this fellow is, about to. Unless he just moves on to the next patch. Oh, he's hiding. You see that, Brian? What he's doing, he's going behind the bush so we can't see him anymore. I just wonder how such a ponderous animal has managed to survive the slings and arrows, if you like, of outrageous history. Do you like my mixing in of Shakespeare there, Brian? Yes. It's the only Shakespeare line I know. It's from Hamlet, everyone, in case you're wondering. Graham, I think what you're asking is partly true, but not quite. You're saying, do tortoises store water at the back of their shells? No, not really, but they do have a little sort of bladder, if you like, just which is situated at the back of the body, but it's not, as far as I know, it's not in the shell. It's actually within the skin, if you like, within the body. And that water is released when they're picked up, and that's why we don't pick them up, because it can dehydrate them. I wouldn't have been averse to picking them up at the waterhole here, except that I think it probably does a bit of psychological damage to pick them up. I don't think they like it very much. And because they're unable to say, "Oi, put me down," we're just not really sure how much trauma it does cause them. He's succeeded, Brian. His stealthy movement has managed to get away from you. Well, Jackie J, you've, I'm sure, seen Jurassic Park, and you're wondering about how it is that this reptile, or what this reptile, has those spiky things on his legs for. And in much the same way, I think, that the dinosaurs used to have spines on bits of their body, this fellow has got spines on his in order to use them for defense. I think when he pulls his legs into his body, those spines kind of stick out. That's what a predator would come to first. So that's what they'd try and bite, and perhaps they'd be slightly less than, less than keen to engage with them. And they've also got quite nasty claws, but I think those are more for grip than they are for defense. Oh, Paul, you're absolutely right, and I couldn't agree with you more. You say their legs look like elephant legs, don't they just? They look exactly like elephant legs. An elephant is substantially faster than a tortoise, of course. But I agree with you totally. They're sort of straight and a squat and, well, pillar-like, really. That is marvellous. Holly, you wondering about the sight that a leopard tortoise has? I'm not sure how well they see. I think they see pretty well. I mean, for a reptile, scent is extremely important. They have a very sophisticated vomeronasal organ, which is just below the brain. Helps them to interpret the slightest hint of molecules of scent in the air. So I think that's probably more important. I think, like what most reptiles, they can probably sense the vibrations of our movement on and other animals' movement on the ground. But I suspect their sight is not bad. I wouldn't say that it's better than ours necessarily, but it's probably better than that of a rhino, for example, which isn't a reptile, Brian.
No,
it's a mammal. Yes. Yes. And there he will sit pretending to be a rock for the remainder of the day. Well done, Mr. Tortoise. Thank you for sharing your life with us briefly. Good. Well, that was a stroke of luck, Brian. Now we will. That wasn't a stroke of luck, really. What have we hit? Shall we carry on? It was a fairly large termite mound, that. Oh well. That's what Scott Dyson used to call reverse by touch. Right, Brent Leo Smith is with Quarantine the Leopard, and I think that he may have found himself a small snack, maybe.
There was just this flurry of excitement as Quarantine was moving towards the cheetah plains pan, and he was just walking lethargically through the heat, and then he pounced on a little scrub hare. There we go, he's got the scrub hare now. Unfortunately, it did take him a little while to kill it, but he's now killed it, and that's what I mean. You never know what's going to happen next out here. He's busy plucking the hare at the moment. He hasn't really started feeding. Of course, a small meal like this, he is quite hungry at the moment. It's not really going to sate him much, so he might get on the move again as it gets cooler. He was on his way, we think, to go have a drink at the Cheetah Plains pan when he stumbled upon this poor, unsuspecting little scrub hare. When he first grabbed it, I initially thought it was a duiker. It was making sounds like a baby duiker or a baby stanbok. But as we got closer and we could see what was going on, we saw that it was indeed a little scrub hare. It seems to be quite a fluffy scrub hare by the amount of fur that's getting caught in his mouth. And he's doing quite a good job at plucking off all the fur. Now, for sensitive viewers, please, this can be sometimes a bit gruesome, especially with a smaller carcass. It can come apart quite quickly, and there can be quite a lot of blood and guts. So please be careful. If you don't like watching this type of stuff, now is the time to just go have a cup of coffee, or maybe change a channel for a few minutes. But unfortunately, this is nature. These leopards need to kill to eat and to survive, as much as the scrub hare needs to avoid at all costs to survive. You can see he's actually removed most of the fur incredibly quickly, so he should start feeding quite soon. So, with this very small prey like this, he's probably going to eat it whole. Tony would like to know, would the hare give him hairballs? Oh, excuse me, Tony. Thank you, Dave. Most definitely it would, Tony. It will give him hairballs. Most things a leopard eat will give them hairballs. So, hopefully he'll be able to get rid of them with not too much effort. So as I was saying, with a small piece of prey like this, he's probably going to eat everything, all the bones. There we go, you can see he's eating the head right now. He's taken the one ear off already. And with bigger prey, he'll normally go for the internal organs first. But with a small little thing like this, it's not going to last too long at all. So he might still go for a drink. There we go, it is now a headless hare. So even though we often find most of the cats on bigger kills, they do constantly make these little kills like this, and they are complete opportunists. I mean, it's nearly 100 degrees Fahrenheit, and he still took that opportunity when it aroused. Just jumped onto it, and I'm afraid it was the end for the poor scrub hare. Hi, AJ. Now, on a small animal like this, AJ is wondering, will a leopard be able to digest the bones? Yes, I think most of the bones will be digestible. They're going to be quite soft and quite easy for a leopard to crunch into small enough bits. So yes, I'd say probably on bigger antelope, sometimes they're not going to be able to digest the bones. Any bit of bone that they're not able to digest is generally passed through, and you'll find it in their feces. So it'll be on the Game Drive channel quickly. Andrew, Ephraim, come in. Andrew, if you're copying, we've relocated quarantine. He's just caught a scrub hare. Just to the east of Cheetah Plains Pan. Sorry about that, just letting the Cheetah Plains guys know, they're just getting moving. So I said, now, that poor little scrub hare is a mere snack for Mr. Q, and he is still quite hungry, so he probably will hunt again this evening. But leopards are incredibly adaptable. They'll eat hares, they'll eat termites, they'll eat fish, they'll eat lizards. There's not much left. I mean, he's already nearly 50% through that poor little scrub hare. Afternoon tea. Now remember, guys, this is happening live from South Africa. We're in the Greater Kruger National Park, 8.5 million acres of unfenced wilderness where these incredible creatures can wander free. Yeah, And we're going to sit here. Hopefully he's going to head towards the Cheetah Plains Pan for a drink while we wait patiently. Let's go see what Jamie's up to.
It sounds as though Brent's been having the most amazing time with a quarantine. Hopefully he does decide to go and have a drink and really complete the afternoon of beautiful images. And I just wanted to update you all on the arrival of Taylor, just by the way, because I am for the first time in about, I don't know, 8 years, wearing earrings, because Taylor's come back from leave and very kindly bought presents for us. So she's very, very sweet. You'll all be happy to know that she has returned from her holiday. After a very long flight and a very long drive this morning, she's having a break. She's having an afternoon off, but you'll all be thrilled to hear that Taylor is back and she will be returning on drive once again. Right, now we have to navigate the minefield. I have a confession to make. I have a secret. James's flat tire. I think it was my fault. And I think, we won't tell James. In fact, I'm relatively certain I know it's my fault. I thought we'd got away. But when I was trying to get into quarantine this morning, I drove over a series of thorns, of thorns much like these thorns that we're about to step over now. And these are green thorns, so they're not quite as savage as the ones that I drove over this morning. I saw them right at the last minute. I backtracked, I went all the way round, I checked the tyres all the way home, we were fine, we were scot-free. Sorry, James. I feel very guilty leaving him with a flat tire. It is just the way of things, though. But what I'm basically saying is I would like to avoid having a puncture to my foot, as I'm sure Jandre would as well. It is the value of good walking shoes. Believe it or not, these are actually quite good walking shoes. The thorns don't tend to make it through. This particular tree, these particular thorns, are part of the green thorn, also known as the Y thorn, or the torchwood. And the reason they are called that, oh goodness, I would have taken the hardest branch to get, wouldn't I? There we go. Clamber carefully over, there we go. The reason they are called that is I can't find a good example. Oh, there I can. Y thorn, that typical divided look to the thorn, it's sort of Y-shaped thorn, essentially. Now, the reason I'm showing you this is because we talk about the Balanites tree or the torchwood tree all the time, but we never really have a chance to closely examine its leaves and its thorns and what makes it such a beautiful tree. And this is obviously a dead one. There is, however, a live one just behind Jandre. So if we make our way over to that, you'll actually have a chance to see why it is called a green thorn and what is so very special about it. Now, this particular specimen that I'm looking at has been pushed over by elephants. So it's now having to change its growth pattern almost completely. Oh, it's very nice and shady in here, like a little sheltered alcove. It's been pushed over, so it's now changing its growth pattern. It's now growing much like that silver cluster leaf that we started the drive with earlier. It's growing now vertically from its horizontal trunk, which goes to show the incredible resilience of a torchwood tree. And the reason it is called a torchwood tree is because it has, I'm looking for a seed, but we're not really in fruiting season for torchwood trees, is because the seed is very, very rich in oils and could actually and was actually used as a torch. By torch, I mean quite literally, not in the South African way that we refer to a torch, which is a flashlight. I mean a literal flame torch. And the roots are very, very alkaline as a way of, it's very soapy. Actually, the roots are very, very soapy. And animals like porcupines and elephants, when they have an upset stomach, they'll go and eat the roots of this tree to calm down, essentially alkalize their stomachs. Now, Debbie wants to know if there are any cacti here. No. We have aloes and we have succulent plants. Cacti, no. There are invasive species of cacti that have been introduced. I have seen not that many of them, but I have seen them around. There is one particular one known as the prickly pear, which we all hate and, speaking from experience, is an absolute nightmare to remove. It doesn't want to leave. As soon as you cut it down, it grows back. You've got to dig it out and then you've got to burn it. And I don't know whether you've ever tried burning a succulent. not very easy at all. It's actually very tricky to do. So getting rid of a prickly pear is a tricky thing, and it's of course one of those lovely things that was introduced because people loved its flowers. They were oh so pretty for their gardens, and so they brought them in at a time where these were farmhouses. I know Brent was talking about the history this morning on his bushwalk. They brought in these lovely flowers, including prickly pears, which turned out to be highly, highly invasive. So then, how to solve this problem? Well, they thought, perhaps we should bring in a special type of insect that feeds only off prickly pears. Biological warfare, if you will, as a way of dealing with it. Turned out to be not such a good way of dealing with it, because this particular mite, and I can't remember what it was called, in the places that it was introduced, proceeded to outcompete every local species. And nothing preyed on it. So therefore, just a sig to the woodland kingfisher. Nothing preyed on it, so therefore it increased very dramatically in numbers. So it just goes to show that best laid plans of mice and men can sometimes be have very, very unpredictable results. So now we rely on natural removal of things like prickly pears. Speaking of prickly pears, let's go over to James, but that sounds a lot meaner than I intended it to be. So let us head over to the wonderful James Hendry and find out how he's doing and if he's not too terribly prickly about the flat tire.
Right, we're just coming around the corner here, and I was struggling to find something to say that was of interest there, so that's what I'm going to say. We were coming around the corner, and we had a nice hornbill sighting, and we had, there's a cuckoo, great spotted cuckoo, which I keep telling you is so rare, and yet we keep seeing them day in and day out. Maybe they're not that rare. Well, clearly they're not in this area. There are dozens of them. The other thing we saw was some waterbuck, but they disappeared into some thick bush. Now, Brian, if I were to say to you, what tree do you think that cuckoo is in, what would you say?
Oh, I don't know.
Well, that is a good answer. I'm going to have a nearly impossible tree quiz, everybody. Let's see if you wouldn't tell me what tree that is. Hashtag Safari Live, question to wild.tv, batteries not included, terms and conditions apply. The great spotted cuckoo is in it because it's looking for tree holes. It's looking for tree holes in which maybe a potential starling host might be nesting. It could also be looking for caterpillars and things, I suppose, but that call it's making is making, it's a sort of territorial call. There it goes. Can you see it? It's a starling actually flying off. That's very cool. There's a virtual starling flying off. That is what that dastardly bird is trying to parasitize. Huh. Fly, starling, fly, and find another place to nest. Go and be free. Good. Do you think he'll come back here?
No.
I hope not. Good. Right, on we go. Right, Brent Leo Smith is having a wonderful time at Cheetah Plains. Go and find out what he's found now.
Well, from one spotted cat to another, we've just left a leopard that killed a scrub hare right next to us. And if you want to see the highlights of that footage, go onto Nat Geo Wild's Facebook page. And now we're with two male cheetah. They've just crossed the southern boundary of Cheetah Plains. If they keep walking in this direction, they're going to walk straight to where we left quarantine. Now here comes the second male. I have not seen cheetahs since August, so I'm just having the best day. And Dangerous Dave, I want a way for him to come back. This is your first full day back from leave. Remember, this is 100% live. You are enjoying these cheetah at the exact same time as us. And remember, if you want to ask any questions, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Isn't this incredible? Now, I wonder if there's any poor unsuspecting impala. Now, when we talk about cheetahs being crepuscular, most active at dusk and dawn, it started to get a little bit cooler, not much, but now is the time. And then both these boys look quite hungry. Now, it seems the luck is definitely on my side today. Most of the time I catch them as they're crossing into Mala Mala. Now they've just crossed into Cheetah Plains. So I'm ecstatic, and we have been waiting for a very long time to watch a cheetah hunt take place on over these wide open plains. Is today the day? Now, Lionheart's wondering what would happen if these two cheetah met Mr. Q, the leopard we've just been with. Now, strange enough, these exact two cheetah have met Mr. Q before. And he was much younger then, and he chased them. So it's likely that if he spots them, he will definitely chase them. The cheetah being so highly designed and so extremely adapted to speed, they've foregone almost all their strength, and any little injury could prove a big problem for them. So they would 99.9% of the time try avoid conflict with an animal as strong as a leopard, and particularly with Mr. Quarantine being as big as he is and as strong as he is, they would avoid him even more. We're just gonna shoot up ahead a little bit. I'm gonna just go around the front of them. Two reasons. One, we wanna get a nice look at their beautiful faces. Number two is we wanna see if there's any impala on the next clearing. So being in the right place for a hunt. Now, cheetah is probably one of the best animals to follow hunting, especially in a particularly open area like this, because you are able to position yourselves perfectly to get the whole hunt happen. Now, of course, there's got to be impala, so fingers crossed. And they're going to scent mark as they go. So cheetah have their favorite scent marking spots, and they will often use them time and time again. Look at that, smelling. Now, the reason a male cheetah move such big distances and have such large home ranges is because they're constantly in search of lady cheetahs, who have even bigger home ranges than the boys. Now, cheetah are the only big cat that need a male dominant, I mean, not a male dominant, a male heavy sex ratio for successful breeding. So all other cats, you will find that there are more girls than boys, except in cheetah. They're scanning towards the edge of the tree line. Oh, they changed their mind. Not heading towards where Mr. Q is anymore. They might head back. Well, they might just be going to a favorite tree to mark. There could be some water left from the rain that they might go have a drink just behind where Andrew is there. So we're just just going to get ourselves into a good spot. We're heading straight towards this area at the moment. So they are hungry. You can see how concave their bellies are. Hello, zombie cow. Zombie cow would like to know, what do cheetah eat the most? Well, I'd say in this area, probably duiker and steenbok and impala were their three most common things that they eat. Let's have a look. They might be heading towards that little mud wallow. Could be some water in it. Get ready with the screenshots. If they stop for a drink, it could be spectacular. It is going to be spectacular. They are stopping for a drink. Now, I hope you guys are getting some great screenshots. Remember to share them on our Facebook page, Safari Live, or pop them on Twitter with the hashtag Safari Live. And I can't help myself. I'm going to have to take one photograph. Hello, Lady Lone Wolf. Lady Lone Wolf would like to know, will these cheetah stay together for life? Indeed they will. It's probably a 90% chance that these guys are brothers. Now, cheetah coalitions, male coalitions, are always made up of related male cheetah, so brothers. And even though only one of them might mate, the other will defend the same territory or home range, knowing that it's genes are being passed down by its sibling. Now, cheetah fights can be quite spectacular. I know of a cheetah fight that happened in Botswana that lasted for just under 48 hours. It was two different coalitions of two males that fought and rested and then fought again and rested and fought again. So they can be quite violent when they want. Generally, they are very, very relaxed around human beings. There's very few recorded cases of cheetah attacking humans outside of captive bred animals. So in the wild, they tend to share away from conflict rather than towards it. The complete opposite strategy to a male lion. Now, the biggest threats to cheetah, of course, from the other animals, is, like with most animals, is lions. They are absolutely gorgeous animals. Hear them drinking. Hi, James. James is wondering, do they ever climb trees? They do indeed, James. And generally, they're not nearly as good at tree climbers as leopards, but they generally prefer to climb sort of trees that have been pushed over by elephants. And it's also the spot where they generally will like to defecate. It's a very good spot to mark your territory out in the open and quite up high. They are quite hungry, so they are going to be on the move. This is the right time of the day for cheetah to be on the move, just as that temperature drops a little bit. And they are that wonderful word I can never get tired of saying. They are crepuscular. which means they are most active at dusk and dawn. So early afternoon, or late afternoon now, going through to early evening, is when cheetahs do most of their hunting. See their very rounded heads and very aerodynamic. Tony's wondering if there's something wrong with one of the cheetah's eyes. Not that I can see, Tony, but I will have a closer look again now. Isn't this just wonderful? What a wonderful afternoon way down in the east here on Cheetah Plains. It's cats, cats, and more cats today. And we're gonna stick with these cheetah for now. You can hear the crowned lapwings are not impressed. They're flying over the cheetah. There's a good spot for a scent mark. Now, Ed is wondering if they came across a female, would they fight each other for mating rights? Ed, they would not. As I said, generally only one coalition member will mate. The other will sit to the side, and that other male is generally happy to let the other male mate because it knows its genetic line is still being passed down. Oh, and here we go, drink and a spot of shade. Now, often you might have heard us say when you're looking for cheetah, especially on these big open areas, you need to look for something that looks like a pile of elephant dung. They're one of the only big cats, or the only big cat that lies completely flat like that, with their head popped up, and sometimes from a distance it can look like a large pile of elephant dung, but it turns out to be the fastest land mammal in the world. So they are more active than the other cats, but they still do have problems dealing with heat, so they will walk a little bit, rest, walk a little bit, rest, just like the other cats. Now we're going to sit here, we're not going to move an inch to see what these cheetah get up to next. While we do that, let's go see what incredible little creature Jamie has found.
We have found one of the most beautiful bugs. I say we. Gendre actually spotted this particular one. And it is one of the most beautiful, and I never thought I'd say this, it is one of the most beautiful, attractive stink bugs I have ever seen. So it is one of the members, or one of the very many. Come back here. Hold on. And stop. Thank you. No, and stop there. No, stop. No, don't stop there. Oh, no. I'm reluctant to manhandle him in any way, partly because, of course, I don't want to manhandle it, but also because there's a reason they are called stink bugs. No, no, no. All right, come onto my hand then. Perhaps that's how we should do things. There you go, Gendre. There's a small window in which you can have a look at him. Just have a look quickly at the beautiful patterns on this particular bug. An incredible purple orangey combination, and very, very symmetrical. There he goes, going towards my thumbnails. Gives you an idea of size as well. There. Isn't he awesome? Such fantastic coloration. Now, why is he called a stink bug? Well, the name is relatively self-explanatory, is it not, Gendre?
Yes.
Have we all experienced it? Yes, we have. Is it something I feel as though the DRC has not yet experienced? Yes, to an extent. The day is coming. Should we take it back? No, we shan't. We shouldn't. We shan't. We shouldn't. Shame. It would be quite sad and very lonely. There's probably more stink bugs, because in my experience, when there is one stink bug, there are many stink bugs. And once they are deceased, they are... What would they be called? I suppose little stink bugs. So the reason they're called stink bugs is if they are squashed or manhandled in any way, they are unbelievably smelly. Paula, you say you're not a bug person, but they have unbelievable colouring. Yes, absolutely. I completely understand that a lot of people are not bug people at all. And in fact, I wouldn't have described myself as a bug person before I started really getting to know and watching. Oops, sorry. That was my fault. I poked it with my radio. And before getting to know them and spending time and watching them and the fascination of their little world, and starting to imagine seeing things from the perspective of something so unbelievably, unbelievably tiny, what the world of giants must look like, and if they experience things at all like we do, or if their perception of the world is completely skewed. Anyway, stink bugs are called stink bugs because they stink. If they are squashed, they give off this absolute pong. I don't know how else to describe it. This malodorous, nose-burning stench. And it doesn't. It's not just a smell, it's a flavor as well, especially if they have wound up in your food. And what often happens is you get... This one's relatively... harmless. It's not problematic at all. And Rebecca, no, they don't bite. They don't bite at all. So they're not dangerous. I'm not worried about touching it. I'm just worried about in any way making it feel uncomfortable so that it releases the noxious chemicals that it contains inside of itself. And I don't know exactly what those chemicals are. I don't know exactly how they work. What you usually find, this one's lovely. It's big, it's clearly visible, it's on its own little plant and not bothering anyone. What you do find is you get this explosion in population of the black-coloured stink bugs, but they're tiny. Tiny, tiny as in a quarter of the size of that little stink bug. And they are everywhere. Absolutely everywhere. When you get a population explosion, they're in your bed, they're in your shoes, you put your head on the pillow, there's one on your pillow, you squash it, crawls onto your hand and you squash it accidentally, or they're in your food, or they're in your wine, or they're in your whatever it happens to be. And you do end up eating them by mistake as well, and that's done. That's your plate of food over. You might as well give up at that point. You'll give up on your meal because they have such an incredibly powerful taste that they completely the flavor's gone, and you're just going to be left with this unpleasant taste in your mouth. So yes, the stink bugs are a reality of life out here. We get them in population explosions. That one's beautiful and harmless, but The slightly smaller ones are not so pleasant. Well, speaking of, let's go from unpleasant things to pleasant things. I can't believe there are cheetah on cheetah plains. I can believe there are cheetah on cheetah plains. I don't know where they were this morning, but we know they've come out this afternoon. So let's go back to Brent.
Unluckily for Jamie, they were south of the boundary this morning, but we must have got to them just after they crossed. So isn't this exciting? We've decided to emulate the cheetah and we've moved into the shade. So Dangerous Dave and myself are behaving just like cheetah, and we're hoping that we're going to be able to get up and follow them on the hunt shortly. So, Dave, bird, on top of the tree. Oh, I think that's a new one for this wet season. Here we go, paradise, wider. You never know what's out here. So that might be, off he goes. Where's his girlfriend? Now, he's on the ground, down, left. There he is. He's keeping Dave honest. To the right. And where's my hand? There. Oh, he just skipped behind the bush. So there's paradise wider. So during the winter months, he is a dull brown, drab little bird. But as soon as summer comes and it's time to impress the ladies, he grows a magnificent tail, gets some rouging on his chest, and is hopefully going to attract all the mates. Now, it doesn't look like he's doing too well at the moment. I don't see any flock of females with him. So you might not have found one yet, but very cool to see that they're in their summer plumage now already. roll for you guys. And of course, we're still with the wonderful male cheetah. Now, we were chatting about cheetah and what would they do if they bumped into the leopard. And strangely enough, I think the first... It is the first sighting I ever had of cheetah when I moved to Safari Live was the day that the quarantine male leopard chased them. And how funny, we've seen both quarantine and the exact same two male cheetah he chased. And that was quite a while ago. And Brian was on camera with me. I love the way they lie with their heads up, looking for any potential prey species that might meander into the open plains. But while we continue to sit here and wait for these beautiful boys to get on the move, James is with a bird just as noisy as himself.
I hope Brent was referring to himself there, as opposed to me. Don't you, Brian? I think that would only be fair. That there, of course, is the wonderful hardy-dar. And there is its little baby. There were three here yesterday. I'm pretty sure there's still three. And what he's been doing, that poor, poor, forlorn-looking chick, is gular fluttering, much like that bird, the first Zazu bird that we saw earlier today. And he's very, very hot indeed. And so he's been sitting there with his little beak open. He looks so terrified, doesn't he? He also looks rather unattractive, wouldn't you say, Brian? He's not exactly a... you see a tiny baby lapwing, for example, and it's like a little pom-pom, and you want to pick it up and put it on your ski hat, for example. But this thing you wouldn't want to put on your ski hat, would you, Brian?
Maybe.
Well, it would look very odd. Yes. And just interesting the size difference there. There's Mum, you can see her shapely leg just above the baby. And she's not small at all. She's probably about, she's probably almost 2 feet long, you know, from tip to toe. And she's giving us the evil eye. There, look, the little one's now doing its gular flutter. Shame. It's so very hot. Poor little thing. It doesn't seem to register just yet that if it's in the sun, it's going to get hotter. I don't see any movement from the others. I'm pretty sure they're there, though, because I think I saw some feathers sticking out from the other side. I love finding nests. It's always so nice to see if they manage to fledge little chicks, and how special it is when they make it through what is a very, very vulnerable time indeed. Now, Brian, sorry, I'm going to ask you to whip around here. In this tree, there's a red, yellow-billed hornbill, and it's going to feed through the nest cavity. The nest cavity is there. There we go. Can you hear the babies? It's flown now. It's just go up there, yeah. And there's the nest cavity, everybody. Oh, up a bit. It's in that kind of slit. There it is. And the only reason I knew it was here was that I saw the shadow cover the sun. He's gone there very quickly. And he's just fed through a caterpillar, through that slit where I think Mrs. Hornbill... Oh, look. I think that's Mrs. Hornbill. That doesn't look like a chick to me. That is so cool, everybody. How cool is that? That's Mrs. Hornbill in her nest. And she's there probably with the chicks. Because I could definitely hear some chick squawking. I just want to check how long they're in the nest for. Let's see if one of them doesn't stick its mouth out again. And we'll just find out quickly. Because I'm sure that male is going to come back very soon and see if he can't perhaps feed them some other kind of caterpillar or worm or grub or something like that. Let me just quickly check. Horn, not hern. Hornbill. There we are. Yellow-billed. Breeding. Eggs. 2 to 6 eggs. Yes, we know about that. We know that the, for example, those hardy-dars are in the nest for 40 days. Nestling period, 42 to 47 days. After that, they fly out. They're only fed for a few days after that by the adults, and then they have to forage for themselves. Wonderful! Now, there are three nests in this area. The other one, I'm afraid, is much more difficult to see. It's a hoopoe's nest. So let's have one last look at the hardedars, and then we'll carry on. We've come into this area hoping to find some sort of sign of the great queen herself. But alas, she doesn't seem to have come here. Right, I believe we have some answers to the... Raisa, you thought that my nearly impossible tree quiz was the low-felt milkberry tree. I'm afraid, Raisa, to have stumped you fills me with a great sense of honour, to be honest. Damon, you said knobthorn. Damon, I'm afraid you're a little bit closer than Raisa, but no, you are wrong. And both of you are wrong, and it does look like a knobthorn tree, but it isn't one. It's a black monkey thorn. And we know that because it's got much smaller leaves than the knobthorn. It was a black monkey thorn, Acacia burkeyi, which I will try and find you at some stage. Right, we're going to just quickly sneak away while that hardy-dar goes to sleep. You see it sleeping, Brian? Let's quietly move away. Right, let's head back to the cheetahs. Go ahead, John.
Welcome back. We're still sitting here. The heads are still up. The temperature is dropping, so we are hoping they are going to get onto the move again. Now, there were some impala through to the north of us. Oh, there we go. Timing is impeccable. Now, you can see... Now, we spent time with leopard and cheetah this afternoon. You can see that even though... Quarantine, the male leopard is a much heavier, bigger animal. The cheetah are taller at the shoulder. Look at the neck, how thin it is. Look at the head, the way it shapes. So they are very, very different from a leopard. And the really interesting thing about cheetah is that their two closest living relatives actually live in the Americas. It's the jaguar gudi cat and, of course, the puma. And it is one of the few cats that only that has semi-retractable claws. And everything about it is designed for the hunt, for the chase, for speed. And in doing so, they've given up almost all their defenses. So again, their best defense is speed when it comes to escaping other predators. Someone is trying to get hold of me on the Game Drive channel. Oh, apparently. Oh, railing out. Johan, Johan. Okay, so I think I'm a bit too far for the northern channel, so I'm just going to call Andrew on the eastern channel and get him to do it for me. Andrew, Andrew? Apparently, Johan from Buffalo's Hook was looking for you. I can't hear him. My northern channel doesn't work down here anymore. Johan from Jacana. Bobby, thanks. Sorry about that. So we're still with the cheetah. Ooh, there's just some golden backlight behind us. We just can't say no to, can we, David? We can't say no to golden backlight. Wasn't that stunning? There you go. Nice swing, Dave. Good form. You can see you're fresh back from leave. Hope you guys remember, share your screenshots on our Facebook page with, or on Twitter with the hashtag Safari Live. Now, you can see how indented their bellies are. They definitely could use a meal. Now, they're heading towards the edge of the woodland. Now, oops, sorry, Dave. Isn't that stunning? Look at that golden light. Andrew, how many other vehicles are standing by here? Okay, so the cheetah's gonna move off. We're gonna try stick with him. But while we do that, I just need to be on the game drive comms for a little bit. So let's go see what Jamie's up to as the sun starts to set.
The sun starts to set and provides us with all kinds of beautiful light. We found something quite extraordinary on our bushwalk, and an absolute first for me in terms of things that I have seen. In this particular case, this very strange bundle, I'm not quite sure how else to describe it that you're looking at, this peculiar looking thing that is resting on the branch in front of you is in fact a living creature that has one of the most unique approaches to camouflage out here. And there are, of course, a few insects that do this, but this particular one I have never seen before. Now, those of you that have been watching these walks for a long time, you will have seen something called a bagworm. And bagworm is called a bagworm because it constructs its own bag, usually of sticks. So it usually looks like I'm trying to look for a good example of some sticks. It's basically just a bundle. Oh dear. Bagworm? Oh well, at least he's well camouflaged. The wind just blew him off, which is such a pity because I wanted to talk to you about how it's clearly constructed its bag out of leaves instead of sticks, but at least you had a chance to view it earlier. It's so camouflaged, I don't know where it's gone. It could be anywhere. It could literally, not anywhere, and literally is probably not the right use of that word. It is probably somewhere in here, but the fact that we found it, that Herbie found in the first place, is an amazing thing. The chance of me finding it a second time. Oh well, onwards. We were looking at that beautiful stink bug a little bit earlier. I have another beautiful creature to show you. I'm not harming it, by the way. It's struggling, but I'm only clasping it very, very gently. It is, in fact, one of our tick species. I'm pretty sure it is a bont tick. There's a couple of different bont ticks, but this is one of them. And it is seriously strong. It's really pushing very hard against my finger to try and pull itself out. But I was trying to compare it to... Sorry, buddy. It's all right. Trying to compare it to the stink bug and the colours of the stink bug and the patterns of the stink bug. Equally pretty and equally unwelcome, I think perhaps is a good way of describing it. Right, before you bury yourself, and I promise you these things are indestructible, so I'm not hurting it in any way. I'm going to pop you away from the bagworm over there. And on that note, it is time for us to head home. The sun is starting to set. It's getting more dangerous to be out here as it starts to get darker. So it's time for us to say our goodbyes. So Jandre, thank you for your wonderful camera work. Thank you, Herbie. And thank you to all of you for joining us, sending through your questions and your comments. You can finish off with Herbie's amazing smile. And it is time for us to say farewell. I'll see you tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari. Until then, bye-bye, everybody, and have a wonderful day.
We're on our way to Treehouse Dam now. We tried twin dams. Nothing is drinking there. And, you know, I think that the dispersal of animals has happened because it rained first here at Juma. So we had a flush of great green here, and we had animals around every termite mound. And then what happened, of course, was that it started raining everywhere else, and everywhere else went green, and so our slightly overgrazed area suddenly wasn't flavour of the month anymore. You know, so we're going from waterhole to afternoon. Weren't those nesting birds very special? I think that's just fantastic. So we had the hornbills, which is a hardy. Now for me, excellent. Brian, it's very unusual that I managed to find so much nests. Now this is a very good question from Safari Dean, to which I think I know the answer. Safari Dean, you say, are there any birds that can fly as soon as they hatch? Well, there are certainly, as you know, I'm sure, that there are many birds that can get up and run as soon as they hatch. The plovers that I was talking about earlier being an excellent example. In terms of flying, I'm going to say no. I don't think that there are any, other than the ostrich, of course, which can fly when it's born and loses that ability to fly as it becomes an adult. That's untrue, Safari Dean. No, and I'll tell you why I don't think they can fly. I don't believe that any bird can fly because of the and the musculature that's required. Mostly, however, the feathers. The feathers are long, they have to be long, and they have to be barbed, and their surface area has got to be enormous in relation to the bird. And for that to happen, I just don't think that they could fit inside. And so I think that there are any birds that can fly at birth. Now there is a waterbuck in the water. What a strange place to find a waterbuck, Brian. Very odd, very odd. Let's hope it likes the sound of squeaking brakes. Oh, yes, all right, we'll go away shortly. There's a grey go-away bird saying, go away. Do you see the water that you can see in the water? Barbel situation or catfish. I think Bill is going to rain next. There we go.
Welcome back, everyone. We just had to give someone else a chance with the cheetahs. So we came back to check where Mr. Q was, and he's moved. But I can hear some squirrels alarm calling. Hang on. Binoculars. Ah, I thought he was being silly and climbing a tree, but he's not. So we heard squirrels alarm calling around where that dead tree is there. So while we wait to look for cheetahs, we might as well look at leopard. He could also be on the move. The temperature's dropped quite a bit. Remember, this is a live African safari, and we had a first today. Dave, quarantined, managed to kill a scrub hare while we were live on Facebook, on the Nat Geo Wild Facebook page. So you can have a look there and see if you want to see it. I do warn you, it is quite graphic. He did play with his food a little bit. Any luck, Steph? Okay. I copy. I'll see if we can get inside if we have any luck. Okay, so we're gonna go sneak through here. I'm pretty sure he's around here somewhere, and see if we have any luck. So if I'm not looking back at you, it's because we are off-roading and I don't want to break another steering arm. He's found him. He's gonna cross our boundary. No, Mr. Quarantine. So he's about to cross across our northern boundary. Oh, quickly. So he's just crossed onto Inkoral. Unfortunately, we're gonna have to have some lovely views of his backside disappearing. There he is. So he's already crossed our northern boundary of Cheetah Plains. And hopefully he'll be back in the morning. You never know. He is quite hungry. He is a magnificent animal. Isn't that gorgeous? So he's going to cross deeper into Inkoral, and we're going to make our way back towards those cheetah. So while we do that, and let's go see how Commander Bond is.
Now we're trying to find, in fact, a very specific thing here. It is a tree agama that we're trying to find, and that is because I like tree agamas. They have pretty blue heads. And we found a couple on a marula tree just near Treehouse Dam the other day. I took a typically rank average photograph of it, and I'm rather hoping to find another. So as we drive slowly along Philemon's cut line here, we're going to scour the tree trunks of all the marula trees and see if we can't see the telltale blue head of the blue-headed tree agama. Now, Brian doesn't want to see an agama, do you, Brian?
I
do.
You say you'd rather see a chameleon.
I would rather see.
Now, Brian, chameleons are very difficult to see in the middle of the day. They're even difficult to see in the middle of the night. Well, that's fair enough, Brian, but we don't always get what we want. I would be so deeply excited if we managed to find a blue-headed tree agama. Then, the other thing, while in the absence of any kind of large predatory or tusked animal, I would like to try and get a piece of the the lighted matches, which of course are the flowers of one of the mistletoe species that we get here. So if we find some obvious ones, we'll do that. I can tell you without doubt that we were not the first people here today. Indeed not. It seems that there was a light-footed lady walking along here, possibly with a slightly more heavily footed man, and then one very heavily footed fellow. Do you think they could have been Jandre, Jamie and Herbie? I think so, most likely. Now, in all seriousness, agamas and lighted matches. None on that tree. I know where Penny's question comes from. Hello, Penny, you're just 7 years old, and you say, do we get any sloths here? No, Penny, we don't. You've been watching Planet Earth, haven't you? I think you have. Planet Earth 2. And, Penny, we don't get sloths here. They're only found, as far as I know, in South America and on the islands around South America. That's where you find sloths, or sloths, depending on how you say it. We don't get any in Africa at all. They are rather special creatures, aren't they? They're very cute indeed. But no, they wouldn't survive here, Penny. There are too many things that would eat them, because they move so very slowly. They're pretty easy to catch. And so in an area with them, as many predators as we have here, I think it's very unlikely that a sloth would survive for very long at all. Gosh, it is rather astounding how few mammals there are out this afternoon. I'm sure they will return shortly. Brian, do you think you would recognize an elephant if you saw it?
Probably not.
I don't know that I would. Andy and Julia, you're in the bush. No, you're not. You're in Los Angeles, we're in the bush, and you're wondering if there are animals out here that are able to sleep for as long as human beings can. In other words, it will sleep for extended periods. There are a few. And it's a very good question, of course, because it may seem like an obvious question to some, but it's a good one because very few are able to afford the luxury of closing their eyes for 8 hours at a time and switching off completely. Lions will do it. As many of you have seen, lions will sleep very soundly, but not like a human being will. They don't ever go into that depth of slumber where you can walk past them, let off a bomb outside their rooms or something like that, and they will not wake up. That doesn't happen with the animals out here. They do sleep for, I think, cubs for extended periods, and certainly young elephants will sleep for extended-ish periods. Nothing like we do for 8 hours, though. Lions will sleep cumulatively for about 20 hours of the day. Leopards, I would say, probably for 16 to 18 hours of the day. Many of the cats also. But, you know, it's not sound sleep like we have. They will always lift their heads up periodically, and the slightest noise will make them wake up. And that, of course, is because they are under a lot more threat than us when we're in a secure environment of sleep. So that's a really actually fascinating question to have asked. And I'm just trying to think, other than the sloth, of course, which we spoke about, are there any other animals in all nature, perhaps in areas where there are fewer predators, that would sleep for as long as we do? And I suspect you'll find things like koala bears, which of course live, which aren't bears at all really, but they live in Australasia, where there are no sort of arboreal predators at all. I think you'll find that they probably sleep for that length of time, but out here, no. Nothing at all will sleep for extended periods like a human being can. What a great question. I've actually never thought of it like that.
So we tend to say a lot about lions sleeping all the time and having their 20 hours a day. They do, but they don't have that sound sleep that we as human beings do. I know when I was a child, really, you could have, the world could have ended outside my window and, well, I wouldn't have noticed. And I know a few people like that now, even adults. I still haven't found any lighted matches for you or Triagamas. I'm sorry, I am doing my level best. Let's stop by the home of Pinchy Weiner and see if he has emerged. Have we got? We haven't gone past him. No, here he is. Oh, Brian, I think it's time that we finally come to the sad realization that Pinchy Weiner is no more. We have had water in the area. We have had sufficient water for Pinchy to have emerged. And Jane, while I answer your question, let us pay tribute to Pinchy Weiner, who was a freshwater crab. And Jane, you say, do Triagamas only live, Like my name, James. Oh, James. Triagamas, I don't think, live only in specific trees, no. I think they live I've certainly seen them in knobthorns, but they tend to live quite a lot in marulas, and I suspect it's because they've got nice, long, easy trunks. And I'm just sorting out sufficient tribute for Pinchy Weiner here, everybody. Pinchy Weiner, for those of you who are perhaps new viewers, was a crab. He lived in that hole that Brian has just showed you, and unfortunately he is, we think, a buffalo sat on him. We think a buffalo sat on him, and that is how he shook off this mortal coil. And so we shall pay tribute to Pinchy Weiner with the marking of a grave. I can't make it stand, Brian. Clearly Pinchy didn't want a tribute left for him. There we are. R.I.P. Pinchy Weiner. Crab. Friend. Character. Entrepreneur. That is quite possibly the most ridiculous segment I've ever done. I cannot leave that there, of course, because somebody's going to come past and think that I've gone stark raving mad, which, of course, I have. It just shows you the depths to which I've sunk in my attempts to find some form of animal life to tell you about. Right, there we go. On we go. I don't believe I just did that, actually. I've And Brian feeds the problem, of course, because he says things like entrepreneur when describing Pinchy Weiner, the freshwater crab who was sat upon by a buffalo. There's a deathly silence from the final control. I think they're all in shock. Let's head across to Brent, get an update from him. I don't know what he's going to be doing for you now.
Copy, thanks, Andrew. Sorry about that. We've just got our gap back to the cheetahs. Off we go. Andrew, unfortunately, you crossed back into Ankoro. Hold on, we're getting to the cheetah now. And they're on a hornbill's nest road. Now, I assume there must be a hornbill's nest on this road at some point, or there was one at some point in time. I have never found one, though. Okay, let's go. We're going to try catch up. They are heading north. It looks like they're probably going to cross in a coral as well. Ah, there we go. We've caught up now. I'm probably going to have to do some maneuvering to get up ahead of them. Just trying to spot them. There they are. Hello, boys. Okay, we're going to have a quick look. And then I'm going to go around to try to get ahead of them. Now, they are moving in the same direction as quarantine, parallel to them. Oh, it looks like they might head further to the east. There you go, Johan's giving it a chance to go forward. I know, okay, I'm just going to zoot around the vehicles. Okay, sorry about this, the game drive channel is a bit busy. Standing by, Andrew. Hey, Finn, thank you very, very much, Andrew. Okay, so they're opposite us, but I'm just going to get up ahead of them so we can wait. And Steve in the UK has asked a question. He said he's heard that cheetah don't do too well where there are lots and lots of lions. Now, Steve, that is mostly true, although I have seen cheetah do very well in areas where there are lots of lions. But generally, where lions are, cheetah females have lots of mortality rates, and in certain parts like the Serengeti, at certain times of the year, cheetah mortalities can be as high as 90%. But normally they're between 50 and 70%, so on par with the other large cats. Here we go, there are the two boys. They are hungry. Now this is the best time of the day for them to hunt. Now, cheetah do climb trees to scent mark. They can climb trees to escape larger cats, and that's what Stephanie was wondering. And except for leopards, of course, Stephanie. Leopards are far more adept climbers than they are. Hold on. And sneak through the little gap here. Oh, get skinny, Dave. There we go. Beautiful. So this is the time of the day when cheetah are the most successful in their hunts, the crepuscular hours. So around dusk and dawn. I just can't get enough of saying the word crepuscular. Now, often people are under the impression that cheetah need big open plains to hunt. They are just as adept at hunting in woodland like this. And for a lot of their range, cheetah occur more in woodland than in wide open plains, because of course there is more woodland than the wide open plains. Okay, well, they are getting quite close to our northern boundary now. They're probably about 60 or 70 meters, maybe a little bit longer, away. I'm going to move up ahead again to try to get one last great view of them. While we do that, James has got a wildly beast.
Now, everybody, we managed to find a mammal, didn't we, Brian? Woo! And it... Sorry. It's a wildebeest bull, and he's on his own and hiding behind a bush. There we go, he's turning his head, now we can see his horns. Now I think this is one of the most underrated animals out here. Superbly designed for high speed, high distance migrations. Gorgeous collection of dark black stripes on charcoal body. Face to die for. Slightly golden lower legs, horse-like tail, buffalo-like horns. I mean, he's an impressive beast, isn't he, Brian? Musculature in his bottom. Look at that. You can see the sinew on either side of his quarters. Now, one must, of course, as they used to say when telling you how to tell a story, it's really how you tell it, not what you tell. And that's how we are telling the story of the wildebeest and now the red-billed oxpecker. I'm very sad that we haven't seen our herd. I mean, I say our herd. But let's head back straight back to the cheetah. They're about to disappear into Nkoro. We'll continue into the western sunset.
Okay, it looked like they might be about to climb this tree. This is the type of tree. Oh, of course they didn't. Oh, but they're getting playful as it gets cooler. Running down. Oh, running. That white patch behind is the boundary. Let's try and keep up with them to get one last view. Okay, we're going to have to just shoot a little bit to get them crossing the boundary. Okay. Hold on, guys. We're going to catch them as they cross, unfortunately, like Mr. Q did, to the north. But what a spectacular sunset safari it has been so far. Here we go, they're probably going to scent mark that false marula. Here we go, the simultaneous scent marking. And unfortunately, there they go, straight across the northern edge of our traverse, not more than 100 meters from where quarantine just crossed. Just sneak forward slightly as we watch them disappear. There they go. Very unfortunate, but we have had some lovely views of them so far this evening. And coupled with Mr. Quarantine, it has been a spectacular afternoon down on Cheetah Plains. And the plains living up to their name today. Well, hopefully, since they're so hungry, they might catch something. So we're going to leave them be. And while we do that, let's go see what feathered friend James has on the ground.
Brian has found something extremely special, everybody. I stopped here in order to show you a blacksmith lapwing. That is not a blacksmith lapwing. It is not even a lapwing. It is a courser. That is the Temminck courser. The only other one I've seen here was on the open areas where you've been watching Cheetah there with Brent. Isn't that cool? Now he's either having a dust bath or maybe sitting on a nest. I can't tell from here. That is very cool. The Temminck courser. Dust bathing, not sitting on eggies. Now it says here that they're nomadic. And what that means, everybody, is that they're not migratory, but it means that they will be in areas like this where they aren't normally, and then they'll disappear again, and then they'll come back maybe that year or many years later. That's so cool. And look, interestingly, the same sort of back of the head as the black-bellied bustard has. You see, that looks a little bit like a snake. I'm sure that's why they're colored like that. So any potential predator thinks, ooh, I don't want to go there. And they are nocturnal, so just waking up as the sun sets, and will wander off to try and catch largely insects and things like that. And it's called a courser for the same reason that we say cheetah, which Brent was looking at, obviously. See, I'm linking, Brian. See the linking the two vehicles together. It's very clever of me. It's described as a courser, same as a cheetah, because it courses after its prey. It doesn't hawk them, which would be what a drongo does, flying down from a perch and grabbing them out of the air. It doesn't do what a lilac-breasted roller does, which flies down onto the ground and grabs prey. This thing will chase them down. Much the same as a lapwing. You see how beautifully hidden he is? If Brian zooms all the way out, he will disappear. That's a remarkable spot, Brian. Well done. Everyone, I'd love to know if you have this on your list. I know we have seen one before on Cheetah Plains, probably more than once, but I wonder if some of you weren't watching that and perhaps you hadn't had him on your list. The Temminck Corsa. That, of course, the blacksmith lapwing, just showing how magnificent he is by stretching his legs. There we are, very nice. I've sometimes described my own legs as lapwing legs, but I'm afraid those are too long. I think mine are more the legs of the sand grouse, really. Ooh, Penny Pine, you were watching this morning, and Brent and Herbert managed to find two eggs from what they think was a Natal Franklin, and you want to know what I did with them. What I did with them was to very lightly boil them for about, 2 minutes each. Then I gently peeled them. I placed them on a bed of very nice rocket some chorizo sausage mixed in with some nice Parma ham. We put a little bit of hollandaise sauce on the top of that and ate them for breakfast. They were delicious. Thank you, Penny Pine, for asking about the eggs that Herbie and Brent found for me. They are sitting on my desk, Penny. I didn't, in fact, eat them. That would be a dangerous thing to do. They're on my desk, and they'll go into the tent the next time we do that, which, of course, will be probably close to the end of this week. We'll be back in the tent, so they're just saving up time before they go back to the tent. I didn't eat them for breakfast. All right, let's carry on and see what we can see as the night starts to fall. That makes me feel very hungry there. Now, I was talking about the tent, and you may be saying to yourself, but why is he going to be in the tent? We don't do the tent every day, and you'd be absolutely correct, of course. We are going into another bout of rehearsals next week, and on the 1st of January, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time in the United States, on Nat Geo Wild, we will be starting the first of an 8-week series that goes every week at 10 p.m. on Sunday evenings live from the Kruger Park. So it'll be 10 to 12 Eastern Standard Time on Nat Geo Wild TV. So that's why we're going to be doing these rehearsals again next week. And we do hope fervently that you will all join us. If you don't live in the United States, I'm pretty sure we'll be doing it still on the internet. So don't worry about that. You're not going to miss out. But we're going all the way to TV for 8 weeks, every Sunday night from the 1st of January, Eastern Standard Time. It will, of course, be the 2nd of January here, morning time, 6 o'clock in the morning here. Brian, do you see that the drainage humps on this road come from the Arethusa rather than Cheetah Plains School of Road Building? Yes. These ones are liable to drive your thoracic vertebra into your lumbar and cervical ones at the same time. Let me slow right down. They're extremely effective. There we are. Right, the lights are on. Time to pull out the spotlight and say, can we see a chameleon? And many of you saying the Temminck Corsa is new to your bird list, so thank you very much for that. I'm now very peckish at the thought of the meal I just described. I do find breakfast my very favorite meal of the day. I think it's a little bit bright still for the spotlight. Our plan from here is to head up to the very far northwestern corner and see if something hasn't crossed in, because the Nkuhumas are over that way. Ah,
Hello, Winter Prism. You're wondering if the TV shows mean that we'll be going to other areas and perhaps extending different areas of the Kruger. No, not for this particular show. We will be on the same area, Juma, Cheetah Plains, Arethusa. Winter Prism, it's not really as simple as just kind of moving away. We have an infrastructure here that has a limited signal range, so we can't just kind of, like we were asked, for example, the other day, would we take a walk in the Drakensberg Mountains? Perfectly reasonable question. Would be a wonderful thing to do, but we're not going to do that because we wouldn't be able to receive a signal. So these are the areas in which we receive signal, and no, I don't think we're going to be extending the traversing at all for the TV. I think we'll be in much the same places that you have come to be familiar with. So not much is going to change on that front. Hello, Sally in Oregon. Yes, I'm afraid you're correct. You say Sundays, 10 p.m. will only be two-hour drives. That is correct. There'll be two-hour drives. Otherwise, I don't think anything will change. But that is not for certain yet. We will still have to decide if the internet shows are going to run completely as normal. They will be largely unaffected. There we have two baby impalas with their mummies. And these little herds, I think, you could call this a herd, it's a bit of a laugh, but, you know, there are four of them. I think you'll find that they are in this little herd and not a bigger herd because these are very new little lambs. So they would have given birth probably, maybe even in the last night, you know. Aren't they sweet? It is very sad to see how many of them get draped over trees by the leopards of the area, but the leopards have to eat, of course. And as I was saying to somebody the other day, and I think I said it to you lot when I got back from the Mara, I said, when we were watching crocodiles eating Thompson's gazelles, for example, as they were trying to swim across the river, there was no question as to who the villain was. Now, this was pointed out to me by Mr. Wallington. He said, you know, a crocodile is always the villain. Nobody ever feels sorry for a crocodile. But when you're watching Karula, for example, eating an impala lamb, it's always with slightly mixed feelings, isn't it? Because you want the impala lamb, that cute little thing there, to survive. And yet also you want desperately for Karula to have enough to eat and to feed her youngsters. So it's mixed feelings. It's never mixed feelings when a crocodile snaps a Thompson's gazelle or a wildebeest out the water. You're always rooting for the wildebeest or the gazelle. Now, I think that's rather interesting, don't you, Brian?
I do.
Yes. On we go. We're heading towards the sandy patch, and Brent Leo Smith is still on Cheetah Plains. I don't know what he's still trying to find over there right now, but I've no doubt with his ample vocal cords, he will tell you.
See, I like the way James talks about my ample vocal cords when he's the one who's heard singing all the time. Fortunately for everyone, I don't sing. Otherwise, I think the people in camp might take me out. Yes, but what a splendid afternoon it's been down here on Cheetah Plains. And Cheetah in Golden Light. Quarantine, one of my favorite leopards, and I remember we actually saw him catch a scrub hare live, and initially I actually thought it was a little duiker from the noise it made. It sounded very similar to a baby duiker or a baby stenbok, and it's amazing the vocal range a hare has. And as I said, you can watch that on Nature Wild's Facebook page. And again, warning, it is a little bit gruesome. He did play with his food a little bit. He let it go, caught it again, let it go, caught it again. But we must remember that that's nature, and that's how that leopard survives every day. Now, hopefully, now that the cheetah and the leopard have gone to Inkoro, maybe it's time for Queen Karula to come back to Juma, and for the Inkorumas to also come back to Juma. That would be quite wonderful, but we will find out bright and early on tomorrow's sunrise safari. And that's the incredible thing, is we're out here every day for 6 hours a day, and we get to follow the incredible lives of this African wildlife. And no filters, no storylines, no scripts. It's real, it's live, and it happens right in front of you. And remember, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you've got any questions about what we do or what we see out here. Dave and I are on quite a high. That was Dave's first ever leopard kill.
Yep.
Not even live or whatnot, his first ever leopard kill. So Dave is still smiling. And a beautiful cheetah in orange light. And then the last time I saw cheetah was in August, so it's been a while. I was really hoping they'd find some impala to chase over an open plain, though. But alas, we can't have it all. Hello, a zombie cow. A zombie cow would like to know, is it normal for an adult leopard to play with its food like that? It is. I've seen we've seen Karula do it with a dika. So it is normal. It's instinctive. Once it's damaged enough that they sort of know it's not going to escape, it's sort of, why not? Pat. Oh, naughty elephant. I wish you were here, because I haven't seen elephants in so long. Right across the road. Okay, there we go. It's a bit too big and heavy to lift that one. Now, we're going to start slowly making our way towards Juma again. We are coming up towards the Cheetah Plains Lodge. And the one thing, actually, I haven't seen the sticks. I haven't seen the new sticks cubs yet. I know Jamie has. I'm not sure whether James has. So who knows? Maybe our luck's running so high we can see the third big cat in one drive. So fingers crossed that Dave and I happen to find the third big cat in one drive. And are we being selfish? But we can always try. While we do that, let's go see how James is faring back on Juma.
I'm just hoping for a mammal trifecta, everybody. Brian, have we seen a mammal trifecta? We've seen a waterbuck. We've seen an impala.
Yes. That's about all there.
And a wildebeest. We got a mammal trifecta. Thank you very much, Kirsten. We are heroes, Brian. We are absolutely amazing, aren't we? So amazing. Who wants to see quarantine and cheetah? I mean, who wants to see that? I just like to breathe in the air, Brian, melt in the sun, listen to the invisible white-browed scrub robin make its final call of the evening. We also, don't forget, saw the Temminck's courser, which was having a very nice dust bath. And maybe there will be something that has come down to have a little bit of a drink at Sydney's dam. Or onto the open clearings here. I'm hoping for at least a few more impala on the clearings here. And soon, in fact, it is definitely by now dark enough for me to be looking for chameleons. Okay, Brian, I'm all right. Don't worry.
I'm also all right, too.
I'm so glad that you're all right, Brian. It's very important that you remain all right. No, not one impala in the clearings. Just a vast expanse of uneaten and very delicious grass. Ah, there's one. There's one. Sean, you should have been with us this morning. You won't believe what we saw. You say you would love to see a hyena. I so wanted to see a hyena today, and I actually went past the dens just to check if there were any around. There aren't, but we saw one on Arethusa. So let's stop and quickly have a look at those impala over there. Impala, look. looking at us, thinking, how do you do? It's worse and worse. What was I saying? I was saying something of vital importance, Brian, about hyenas. That's right, Sean. We saw a hyena on Arethusa today, which was very nice indeed. It was a very happy hyena. It was sitting in some mud in the water at 6:30 as the volcanic sun took to burning us to a cinder. It looked like the best possible place to be at that time of the day. And then I was inspired, like I said, to come back to Juma and have a look around some of the den sites here. And I'm afraid they're not back yet. They're still in the Manileti, which is quite a long way to the north of where we are now. So let's watch the frolicking impalas for a little while. They do this quite a lot in the morning. And clearly also in the evening, the youngsters run around. It just helps them to sort of... it's an extremely important part of what animals do, of course. And I've said this before, and probably exactly the same time of year. The playing that animals do helps their neurological systems, their nervous systems, and their musculature, and their bones, and their ligaments, and all that sort of thing, all of them to coordinate with each other to create the adult form. They need to make their muscles strong, and the play behavior helps them to do that in the same way that it does with kids. And that's why, of course, we're all slightly panicked by the amount of time children spend staring at screens rather than running around, digging in the sand and, well, pushing each other about the place, I suppose. You know, when I was a child, Brian, we had to go and play outside. We weren't allowed to watch television. We only got television very late in my life. That's not untrue, everybody. We got television in South Africa in 1976. The government at the time, very backward indeed, thought that perhaps the television was designed by the devil and that we therefore shouldn't watch it. But now, we have TV and we have internet. We can live stream Impala to you into your living rooms from where we sit here. Look at those two funny little things on the far left there, having a little box. And you know what? We definitely can see the different characteristics that Hosanna and Shongile have. And I've no doubt in my mind that Impala youngsters also have different characteristics. But of course, we don't spend enough time with them as individuals, because yes, we may well see that impala that we're looking at browsing now, and bear in mind it's only 2 weeks old and it's browsing already. We may well see that one again, but to recognize it would be almost impossible. So I'm sure some of them are shy, some of them are more playful than others, some of them are dim-witted, some of them are intellectual giants of the impala world, able to count to three with no trouble at all. Right, we're going to try and move now, see if we can. We seem to have some strong signal. Are you ready, Brian?
I'm ready.
Dun.
Welcome back. Apologies about that. And we are live in the bush. So what Dave and I are doing is just slowly sidling down the road. I'm just looking for my light. There it is. I think I can hear a little owlet, which is the reason I turned off the vehicle. But I'm hoping it's not a drongo imitating. I think I spot him. Oh, there's two, one on either side of us. Or is it the drongos causing trouble? Let's check this side. Let's roll a little bit forward. Now, of course, fork-tailed drongos like to imitate these little owlets. They're always looking for a fight. They've gone silent now. I'm just going to move off the road here. Now, we're sitting on a crest. And there's a little river in front of us called the Mawanini, and that far crest in the distance there is Juma. And you can just make out the Drakensberg Mountains if you zoom there towards the clouds. A little bit to the left, away from the electricity poles. There we go. You can see there that far crest where that top pole is, that's Juma. And it's amazing. It's that strange time of the day when it's the changing of the guards. It's almost completely silent as the daytime animals finish their calling and the nocturnal animals start theirs. Except for, of course, the one fork-tailed drongo. Some cicadas. One fork-tailed drongo. So that answers the question, who was doing the pearl-spotted owlet call, or mimicking it at least. But I know, this is Torchwood next to us here, and I know there's a male lion not too far away, so I was just trying to see if he might give us a little... Now, the Birminghams have been nice and vocal recently. It's amazing. It's just a completely different sound as the day goes tonight and all the nocturnal critters come out. Hi, a cat in Tampa. She says, has it been overcast? She hasn't seen a sunrise or a sunset. Well, we've had a bit of both, but there have been quite cloudy mornings that have built through to heat during the day, and then that heat during the day has actually caused cloud cover to come in from about the time we go live, except for today. The sun tried to melt us. I think I applied sun cream about 6 times during that quarantine sighting. It was blisteringly hot. There he was hogging all the shade, selfish leopard that he is. I'm going to move a little bit further down the road. No owls, unfortunately, just the pesky drongo looking for a fight. Now, we've had a splendid, splendid afternoon down in the east. Sometimes we go down there and it's deathly quiet. The odd impala, the odd wildebeest. But today it was incredible. We were incredibly spoilt by 2 fantastic big cat sightings. So we are going to now head off towards dinner on Juma and from Dangerous Dave. Oh, I nearly forgot Dave. So Dave has just got back from leave and he told me that he was the hottest thing on the Cape Town beaches.
No, I didn't.
So from Dangerous Dave and myself, it's been an absolute pleasure. So let me rephrase. From Dangerous Dave, the hottest thing on the Cape Town beaches this summer, and myself, Brent, we'll see you bright and early tomorrow morning for the sunrise safari. Let's go see how Commander Bond's doing.
Well, everybody, we're now got just a few minutes left to try and find a chameleon. We're doing our best, aren't we, Brian? Scouring every bushel, every leaf for the telltale luminous green sign of a chameleon, flap-necked version thereof, only version that we get here. I've always been slightly surprised by that we only get one chameleon in this part of the world. There are some others down in the Cape, many, of course, in Madagascar, which ceased to be part of Africa many years ago. Even before I was born, do you know that, Brian? That's how long ago it was. Anyway, we might be lucky. Let's see. We'll drive a little bit faster to cover a little bit more ground because we don't have much time left. Isn't it interesting, as Brent was saying, we were talking about the sunset and sunrise, and we don't see a great deal of sunset. And in fact, we do. I don't know why he was saying we don't see the sunset and the sunrise. Why was he saying that, Kirsten? Oh, because of the clouds, I suspect. Is that what he meant? I think there have been some lying storm clouds in the west in the afternoons and in the mornings. I mean, we're out at the right time for the sunrise, but it's just that the clouds have been around for a while before they've sizzled off completely to burn us to pieces in the middle of the day. I have found one chameleon all season, Brian. It is rather sad. How many have you seen?
Two.
I wonder if this isn't a hangover, if you like, from the drought. I'm pretty sure that's what it is. Any nocturnal creature would be very pleasant. There is a civet who lives around here somewhere. Yet to see him, of course. We'll just do a little turnaround quarantine, as has become the tradition. Oh, there, Brian, look at that. It is a member of the rabbit family. A scrub hare with its red eyes. I think these are hugely underrated animals. This is our fourth mammal of the day, Brian. Fourth mammal.
Incredible.
Gee whiz. Our cup truly runneth over. This one is alive, isn't it? Yes, look, it's chewing. Now, of all the animals and their digestive strategies, of course, the scrub hare is a very interesting one. It does something called coprophagy, which I'm sure many of you know, but some of you probably don't. And so, unlike a ruminant, which will bring its food up again, rechew it, and swallow it, the scrub hare, on the first passing, the food comes out of its bottom as a kind of, like a jelly almost, and it re-eats that directly. Eats it again, digests it again, and it comes out as a sort of hardened, pale pellet. And you can definitely identify them. They're sort of Steenbok-sized. No, in fact, they're a bit bigger. They're almost impala-sized. Very plain kind of tan brown. All right, everybody, that is going to be it from us tonight. Thank you, Brian, for your efforts. Well done. Mosquito Thumb says bzzz, goodbye. Very nice. A big thank you to Kirsten in the final control, being ably assisted by Louise Pavide back again. Hello, Louise. Lovely to have you with us. And, of course, to Jamie and Brent and David and Jandre. We will see you tomorrow again at 5 o'clock. Bye-bye.